Conference of the United Nations on International Organization is now convened.
The United States and the Soviet Union are now among the chief artisans of the new international order.
The very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society.
Memorandum, dated 19th of June, 1964. Subject, Soviet research and development in the field of direction and control of human behavior. Current research indicates that the Soviets are attempting to develop a technology for controlling the development of behavioral patterns among the citizenry of the USSR in accordance with politically determined requirements of the system.
And we are, as a people, inherently and historically opposed to secret societies, to secret oaths, and to secret proceedings.
Shortly before his assassination, JFK had been warning about a system operating from the shadows.
And there is very grave danger that an announced need for increased security will be seized upon by those anxious to expand its meaning to the very limits of official censorship and concealment. That I do not intend to permit to the extent that it's in my control.
Repeating, President Kennedy has been shot by a would-be assassin in Dallas, Texas. Stay tuned to CBS News for further details.
It takes more than an instant to make a real cup of coffee.
Furthermore, the same technology can be applied to more sophisticated approaches to the coding of information for transmittal to the population targets in the battle for the minds of men.
We must guard against the military-industrial complex.
Now, in this experiment, this is the apparatus we use.
Changes in behavior, changes in mental attitude.
The transmitter changes the message into the signal.
Did you ever consider what would have happened if any of these substances were given to, say, unwitting people?
Research has become central, or by, or at the direction of the federal government.
You know, up to now, I kept thinking that everything science did was good. Now I'm not so sure.
We must also be alert to the equal and opposite danger that public policy could become the captive of a scientific, technological elite.
On April 13, 1953, newly appointed CIA Director Alan Dulles signed off on MKUltra, the CIA's top-secret mind-control project. 3 days before that, he gave a speech on the battle for men's minds to justify it.
For Dulles, it was a missive into a newly declared battle for the minds of men, and would come just weeks after he became CIA director as a countermeasure to Soviet, quote, brainwashing. The speech effectively launched MKUltra and gave a plausible reason for the dark and disturbing research. Dulles would sign the memo, creating the CIA's most notorious secret research project, just 3 days later, and ironically only a few weeks after the death of Stalin, who had ruled Soviet Russia for 25 years with an iron fist.
Super-secret Project MK-Ultra, as it was called, was carried out by the CIA from 1953 to 1964, and when it finally came to light during the Church Committee congressional investigations in 1975, it proved to be one of the most bizarre episodes in CIA history.
It was often dismissed as a half-cocked effort of a paranoid Cold War spy agency.
The public wouldn't even learn about the project's existence until the mid-70s.
NBC News has new information on mind experiments done 20 years ago without the patient's knowledge, experiments funded by the CIA.
A decision was made at the highest levels of the CIA to do testing on unwitting Americans.
I hope I have a reasonable moral standard.
MK was a cryptogram for the Office of Technical Service under the CIA's clandestine Science and Technology Division. The huge experimental endeavor would weaponize science and psychology under more than 140 sub-projects.
But it was really about controlling human beings, both individually and in mass, in every way researchers could dream of.
The initiation of MKUltra would weaponize the techniques explored by big science, which for many decades had been funded and promoted by the Rockefeller, Carnegie, and Ford foundations, while the general public remains largely ignorant of the sinister experiments taking place under taxpayer funding and behind closed doors.
Soviet research on the pharmacological agents producing behavioral effects has consistently lagged about 5 years behind Western research. They have been interested in such research, however, and are now pursuing research on such chemicals as LSD-25, amphetamines, tranquilizers, hypnotics, and similar materials.
Among other things, investigators found the CIA had been testing the drug LSD on unsuspecting humans. One man given the drug committed suicide. The committee was never...
MKUltra would mostly be remembered for its drug experiments.
I'm going to give you this cup that contains lysergic acid 100 microgram. Will you drink it?
That's acid.
Characterized by hallucinations, illusions, distortions of perception, and thinking.
John Gittinger, recently retired chief psychologist for the CIA.
We could disable a whole city by putting a very small amount in a water supply.
Everything from prostitution studies to poisons to top secret weapons like the heart attack gun grabbed headlines with sensational accounts of the CIA's sketchy techniques.
Have you brought with you some of those devices which would have enabled the CIA to use this poison for, we have indeed, for killing people?
Good evening. The White House disclosed today that the CIA's drug testing program on unsuspecting Americans had been more extensive than the agency had admitted.
CIA secretly funneled money through scores of research foundations, colleges, hospitals, and clinics,
including a $375,000 grant through the Geschichte Research Fund here in Washington.
The complex and compartmentalized management of such a large project, through front groups and with the participation of countless agencies and institutions to carry out secret research, should be a testament to just how sophisticated and shadowy government science had become.
Their names of doctors, their names of officials, their names of former and present CIA officials who were involved, names of hospitals. And depending on how you treat it, it could be sensational.
Dr. Sidney Gottlieb, the man in the center, was the CIA's chief chemist and in charge of Project MKUltra.
Gottlieb, chief of the technical services staff chemical division who signed off on each MKUltra subproject, was given complete immunity in exchange for his testimony before Congress.
In a recent deposition, Gottlieb conceded the CIA was interested in retrograde amnesia, or blanking out a period of time in a person's memory.
Ultra involved hundreds of different drugs and substances, hypnosis, narco-hypnosis, sleep and sensory deprivation, and other behavior modification therapies.
This information indicates the CIA was interested in learning how to erase memory.
They are former patients, part of a CIA-funded experiment, MKUltra.
I've heard that it was the most brutal program under MKUltra.
Like they had complete control over me.
Tens of thousands of people across North America and the world were involved in these experiments.
Drug testing on American citizens was more widespread than previously believed.
They included experiments secretly involving hospitals, testing drugs on terminal cancer patients, and enlisting prisons to experiment on criminal sexual psychopaths.
Military soldiers, civilians, inmates, hospital patients, and even children. Without regard to consent.
It is doubtful that any meaningful form of consent is involved in this case.
Virtually no aspect of potential control of human beings went untested.
The work was done by the late Dr. Ewan Cameron. It involved extensive use of potentially dangerous drugs, excessive electric shock treatment, and endless tape-recorded messages to sleeping patients.
Dr. Cameron wanted to erase, rewrite, and program the mind and the person with all new thoughts and behaviors. And he used CIA and Rockefeller Foundation funding to do it.
Cameron wrote, "This was the way to make direct, controlled changes in personality." Is that what you were interested in?
And it would say over and over again the actual words that the individual had said. And Dr. Cameron's idea, apparently, was that if somebody listened to this long enough, that it would represent some kind of a breakdown, and a breakdown in a psychotherapeutic sense.
Some heard the same message 250,000 times.
MKUltra itself had 149 sub-projects, at least that we know about. You see, in 1972, after President Nixon fired CIA Director Richard Helms, he ordered the destruction of all MKUltra documents.
The committee was never able to determine the full scope of the program, since one-time CIA Director Richard Helms acknowledged that the program's records were destroyed in 1973 to avoid embarrassment.
It's only due to a clerical error that 7 boxes of financial records were spared, which were later released via FOIA request in 1977. Because of this, the public will never fully know how far MKUltra truly went.
As this 1952 CIA memo says, the aim is controlling an individual to the point where he will do our bidding against his will, and even against such fundamental laws of nature as self-preservation.
The CIA files that were made public were referred to in testimony by participants in the project, such as Dr. Charles Geschichter and Dr. Robert Lashbrook, as, quote, boilerplates. Cover files that Dr. Geschichter noted were not worth the paper they were printed on. So while we'll never truly know the particulars of the MKUltra sub-projects, what we can gather from these so-called boilerplate cover files is bad enough.
The CIA did have a great interest in amnesia.
Subproject 23 tested the effects of certain drugs on the central nervous systems of terminally ill cancer patients. Subproject 87 talked about purification of extremely high-potency allergens with, quote, greater potentiality. Subproject 115 studied the mentally disturbed in their environment to gain further insight into influencing human behavior. Subproject 40 investigated the feasibility of aerosols to deliver various psychochemicals of interest to the CIA on non-psychotic humans. Subproject 128 tested a method of rapid hypnotic induction, while Subproject 138 involved body antennas, personal tagging, radiant energy measurement, and remote polygraphs. But the most promising means of mind control would be largely downplayed, both in the hearings and the media.
Dr. McNulty says he finds it despicable for a democracy not to ask an institution if they want to be involved in such an activity. Perhaps, he added, the plus of a democracy is eventually we learn about everything.
Not everything.
At no time has the CIA engaged in any political activity or any intelligence activity that was not approved at the highest level.
Two major methods of altering or controlling human behavior. The first is psychological, the second, pharmacological. Neither method would be very effective for single individuals on a long-term basis.
No trial, no jail time, no explanation beyond the CIA's need to create Manchurian candidates.
Raymond.
Yes, ma'am.
Do you see the Red Queen?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, here's what I want you to do.
Key players given immunity, and the main bad guy, Ewan Cameron, vilified in the press. Pretty convenient to scapegoat him since he died a mysterious and untimely death hiking in the Adirondacks in 1967. Even the newspapers couldn't agree on whether it was a heart attack or an accident. No one knew that some of the men directly involved were the most well-respected and celebrated names published in leading scientific journals and defining the fields of psychology, psychiatry, and neurology. Men who simply went on treating patients as if nothing ever happened. And no one fully grasped that MKUltra was simply a dark hallway in a much larger labyrinth. Cameron didn't work in a vacuum.
Alan Dulles and Ewan Cameron were acquaintances who crossed paths in their OSS days as psychology increasingly affected warfare. Cameron was on the medical panel for Nuremberg and assessed Rudolf Hess after he claimed amnesia.
And that the only defect from which he is suffering is forgetfulness about what happened before he flew to England.
The Rockefeller Foundation had provided more than $150,000 to establish McGill's new psychiatry department, which Cameron would head at the newly created Allen Memorial Institute, built inside of Canadian shipping magnate Sir Hugh Allen's Ravenscraig Castle, the most historically elite building in Montreal. Cameron would draw from his distinguished colleagues at McGill. Using sensory deprivation, electroshock treatment, deep sleep therapy, and tape loops to erase memories and break down personalities. In a paper published in the 1956 American Journal of Psychiatry, Cameron referred to the technique he called psychic driving as, quote, analogous to the breakdown of the individual under continuous interrogation. Seeking recognition, Cameron hoped to earn a Nobel Prize for automating psychiatry. Only three sources were cited in his work, the first being himself and another being Donald Hebb. With the influence of his connections, Cameron rose to prominence, becoming the president of the Canadian, American, and World Psychiatric Associations, along with numerous other influential groups. He was widely acknowledged as a leader in the entire field, until he wasn't. What a fine line there was between the work of a madman exposed in the worst of the files released on MKUltra and the respected and admired work of his closest colleagues at McGill, who even today are celebrated as the greatest Canadian minds of science. But Ewan Cameron didn't work in a vacuum.
Stimulation at point 2, sensation in thumb and index finger, quivering, tingling. Point 3.
I hear voices. It is late at night, around the carnival somewhere.
1934, Montreal, Canada, McGill University. Dr. Wilder Penfield had already mapped out much of the cerebral cortex by placing electrodes on the brains of his epileptic patients.
Point 4.
Some sort of traveling circus. I just saw lots of big wagons that they used to haul animals in.
The Rockefeller Foundation spent more than $1.25 million to create McGill's Montreal Neurological Institute and recruited Penfield to head it after ruling out basing his controversial research in New York. The medical ethics differed slightly in Canada, and reforms of the 1930s emphasized the character and reputation of doctors over any legal burden on their conduct. To satisfy this, Dr. Penfield conducted, quote, treatments of last resort on only the most serious of epileptic patients.
During my life as a brain surgeon, it has been necessary to operate on a good many men and women, good many hundreds, and to expose the brain under local anesthesia with the patient conscious.
While simultaneously undergoing a study of the brain to make the price of open brain surgery worth it.
If I simulate again, a little lower down.
That pencil-like instrument in his hand is an electrode. Each time he applies it to the patient's brain, a weak electric current stimulates that part of the brain.
Point 7, movement of the tongue. Point 8.
Yes, I heard voices down along the river somewhere. A man's voice and a woman's voice calling.
Nearly two decades earlier, Wilder Penfield had become Sir Sherrington's most distinguished pupil. Penfield trained at Oxford under a Rhodes Scholarship, who were known for recruiting top American students to become elite agents of global influence in their fields. It was Sherrington who introduced Penfield to neurology, and Penfield dedicated all his books to his mentor. Real legacy stuff.
Point 11.
I think I saw the river, one I was visiting when I was a child.
This was experienced from his earlier life. It has faded from his recollective memory.
He claims in this way that he avoided outright experimentation.
These are not experiments.
Though few other labels could truthfully be put on his probings.
Is it true that one does not feel pain in the brain itself?
No, it doesn't hurt to stimulate the brain.
Ready, on?
I had a dream I wasn't here. I hear people coming in. I hear music now. an old song I heard on the radio. A funny little piece.
These reenactments contained both visual and auditory elements in them. This was an incident of childhood which she could never have recalled without the aid of the stimulating electrode.
You'll see how it evokes a body movement or a sensation.
Ready? On? Buddy, did you feel anything?
Yes, I did.
What?
I felt that my hand was numb.
Electrical stimulation was carried out at 60 cycles, 2 millisecond pulses at 2 volts. Point 27.
It is winter, and the wind is blowing outside, and I'm waiting for a train.
Now, if I stimulate again, further forward. Ready? On.
Kneel. Left hand is shaking. Left wrist is twitching.
He's awake through all this?
He's awake through it all.
Left wrist is twitching.
He can tell the surgeon things that will be helpful to the surgeon in terms of this brain mapping.
That's why he's kept awake.
In that process, we have stumbled quite accidentally on the fact that there is recorded in the nerve cells of the human brain the complete record of the stream of consciousness.
And Penfield identified their association with areas of the brain for motor movements, for speech, for memory, and other complex brain functions.
I seemed to hear little voices then, the voices of people calling from building to building somewhere. I do not know where it is, but it's very familiar. They seem to be run-down buildings.
He even found parts of the brain that stimulated auditory and visual hallucinations, and where dreams were stored, or at least stirred from.
Dream is starting. There are a lot of people in the living room. One of them is my mother.
It is a useful, practical procedure to stimulate the cortex electrically.
The electrode recalled the smell of burnt toast in the woman's mind, which had seared into her memory during a key seizure.
Dr. Penfield, I smell burnt toast.
For this moment, Penfield was later dubbed the greatest living Canadian. Even though he was American by birth and he only later took citizenship, the Canadian government even made a commercial about this scene to celebrate his life.
We just called him the greatest Canadian alive.
Penfield destroyed the associated part of the brain and she was, quote, cured. But not all patients were so lucky. A patient referred to as DT became speechless during the removal of a large portion of the dominant side of his brain and died of pneumonia a week later, withdrawn and unable to speak. Despite the deliberate destruction of the man's brain, Penfield somberly noted that the autopsy showed no obvious cause of the speechlessness or of his death. For Penfield, these risky experimental surgeries were worth it. He was creating what was known as the homunculus, a veritable map for the outer cortex, and a code towards understanding the inner workings of the brain. Under Penfield, McGill became a gravity, a central focal point for future research to orbit around. Not so much for the cure of brain diseases like epilepsy, though that too would move forward, but in the quiet conspiracy of brain doctors and their patrons who had become determined to identify the buttons of the brain and push them for shadowy agencies of the government. In the trenches of neurophysiological control was Donald Olding Hebb, a Canadian who started at McGill in education, left finding influence in experimental psychologist behaviorist Carl Lashley. Hebb returned to McGill in 1937 under a Rockefeller Fellowship to work with Dr. Penfield. Penfield's homunculus provided Hebb with a map to behavior inside the functions of the brain. By the time he published his seminal 1949 work, The Organization of Behavior, he'd spent more than a decade and a half studying learning. Learning in the neurological sense of actions in the brain, and learning in the sense of conditioned behavior.
The brain, a pulpy mass of cells and fibers.
Bonding, imprinting, and early experiences had a huge influence in the development of personality and could be used to predict future behavior as well.
We have to learn through our own past behavior the significance of the impressions our sense organs bring to us.
And if it were true in primates and other higher animals, it may also be true in humans.
Donald Hebb was placed at the head of McGill's psychology department. The work at McGill provided a new blueprint for conquerors of the mind to follow, and the military and national security agencies wasted no time in seizing upon its dark potential. In June 1951, a clandestine meeting on MKUltra precursor projects Bluebird and Artichoke was convened at the Ritz-Carlton Hotel in Montreal to coordinate what else? Mind control research. Professor Donald Hebb, who had been secretly placed at the head of behavioral research for Canada's Defense Research Board, was a key participant, along with two Americans identified in meeting notes simply as CIA. Dr. Hebb provided an approach to the military application of confessions, interrogations, and the use of psychological coercion to change one's beliefs and values that was based around sensory deprivation, the simplest path to intervention in an individual mind. Hebb proposed that, quote, cutting off all sensory stimulation, the individual could be led into a situation whereby ideas, etc., might be implanted, that a mind plucked from reality through shutting off the senses could be easily softened, remolded, or even shattered.
The psychological aspects of behavior control would include not only conditioning by repetition and training, but such things as hypnosis, deprivation, isolation, manipulation of guilt feelings, subtle or overt threats, social pressure, and so on.
Tests are being conducted in Canada.
He quickly received ample funding from the Canadian government, a CIA front group, and foundations like the Rockefeller and Ford Foundations to test out his sensory deprivation theories on graduate student volunteers at McGill.
Looks to me like he's been in an accident.
No, this is an experiment that took place at McGill University. Students volunteered to participate in this study of human behavior under extreme and prolonged monotony.
They were isolated and immobilized in a small lit cubicle, their arms placed in large cardboard tubes up to the fingertips, with light diffusing goggles placed over their eyes. The little rooms were soundproof except for a constant white noise generated by a small air conditioner. These conditions continued 24 hours a day, even at mealtimes. It didn't take long for the subjects in Hebb's black box to break down. With Hebb writing of one man, the subject's very identity had begun to disintegrate. The extreme sensory deprivation of Hebb's experiment proved blatantly devastating. Few of the volunteers could take it for more than 2 or 3 days.
It was impossible for most of these students to take it for more than 24 or 48 hours.
At least 4 participants in Hebb's experiment openly referred to it as torture. The monotony from a lack of sensory stimulation amounted to much more than mere boredom. It unveiled a mind that lost complete touch with reality when it fell out of contact with it.
The psychologist D.O. Hebb and his associates, who conducted these experiments, found that deprived of ordinary, everyday sensory experiences, the subjects began to lose touch with reality.
Dr. Hebb discovered a clear threshold at which a man's mind, any mind, would break down within a matter of days. Many participants hallucinated within just 48 hours.
Those who stuck it out began to see things, hear things.
Some felt their heads had become disconnected from their body. Others felt they had 2 bodies. One claimed he saw purposeful squirrels marching with sacks over their shoulders, while another claimed he'd been attacked by pellets fired from a miniature rocket ship. Hebb and his researchers concluded, a changing sensory environment seems essential for human beings, noting that without it, a major breakdown in thought processes akin to a psychotic break could be quickly achieved in just a few simple, inexpensive steps.
They had also discovered that a total lack of sensory stimuli made a person highly suggestible with long-lasting effects. Not only were Hebb and his team able to make their subjects believe in ghosts, poltergeists, and outlandish stories after spending time in sensory deprivation isolation. But even weeks later, many of them retain their fear of the paranormal, often in spite of their previous beliefs. The implications for brainwashing, indoctrination, and re-education were staggering. Although the Canadian government and intelligence agencies had classified Hebb's work, it leaked out through stories from the volunteers, raising questions in Congress in the mid-50s. National Institutes of Health Director Robert Felix testified at a hearing that if you deprive someone of their senses for long enough, they will become totally disoriented in time and space and in their entire thought process. Without external stimuli, one is left in a closed circuit. Thoughts will go round and round and round in an endless loop. When the information is fed back in, and it's the only information available, what else could be the result? But that even nonsense would be a logical conclusion. When isolation is used as a weapon, Dr. Felix made clear, anyone could be broken down by this technique.
In the coming years, Hebb and Pinfield were surrounded by MKUltra research at the epicenter of McGill neuroscience. The two trained numerous acolytes who had spread their influence in the field across the globe. One of them was Dr. Maitland Baldwin, a protege of Hebb and Pinfield's who also studied removal of the brain at McGill. Baldwin was known for his bizarre monkey experimentation, which involved giving LSD to monkeys after surgically removing portions of their brains. He also transplanted the head of one monkey onto the body of another, that kind of stuff. He not only continued Hebb's sensory deprivation experiments, but pushed them much, much farther, although he admitted that anything beyond 2 days would likely cause irreparable psychological damage, something Baldwin discovered while at the National Institute of Mental Health, when he placed an army volunteer in a specially designed box and witnessed the man break down into heart-rending sobs before kicking his way out after just 40 hours. Baldwin felt certain that the cruel yet simple technique of sensory deprivation could break anybody. Regardless, authors Alfred McCoy, John Marks, and others have reported that Baldwin was quite willing to do terminal-type experiments in this area if the CIA would provide him with expendable subjects. History claims it was actually the CIA who declared Baldwin's proposal as immoral and inhumane.
I hope I have a reasonable moral standard.
Stopping it before he could begin, so he went ahead with monkeys instead. The results of his research remain classified to this day.
Hebb had refused to go further in the interrogation experiments, and his funding was cut a year later. Hebb wrote to the Canadian Defense Board, expressing his frustration at doing the thankless work for the CIA while his research was suppressed and not allowed to be published. While the CIA turned to Hebb's colleague at McGill, Ewan Cameron, to continue the experimentation that Hebb had begun.
Author Alfred McCoy claims that a lawsuit forced the Canadian government to admit Hebb's close ties with the CIA, including a 1963 briefing that coincided with the release of the agency's Kubark manual. The Counterintelligence Interrogation and Psychological Torture Manual based largely on Hebb's findings, in addition to granting Hebb a special CIA security clearance in 1964. Ultimately, Hebb, a respected university figure, was willing to go only so far with his debilitating research.
If the CIA was serious about pursuing behavior modification and mind control, then it would need a team of serious investigators to carry out scientific experiments regarding the very mechanisms underlying behavior itself, and thus the mind. And the essential question, is man programmable like a machine?
Like a machine? Like a machine?
In watching an electronic data processing system in operation, you are struck by how few people are involved. This impression is misleading. There are more people behind the scenes than first meets the eye.
During the early 1950s, Dr. Hebb had taken part in the CIA's top secret Project Bluebird, which aimed to develop techniques to get people to, quote, sing like a bluebird, even against their own will. As experimentation continued, Bluebird quickly evolved into Project Artichoke, which in turn evolved into what would become MKUltra. And subsequent covert projects thereafter. But covert, organized scientific research had already begun years earlier under the auspices of government committees and private foundations leading up to World War II. Early on, a number of social scientists, psychiatrists, and psychologists were tapped for the Presidential Advisory Committee for National Morale in order to advise the government and military on psychological warfare in anticipation of America's entrance into the war. The Morale Committee conducted in-depth research, much of it classified, into psychological operations and countering enemy propaganda, while ensuring the American public's support for the war through domestic propaganda. The committee also proposed secret research into methods of enhanced interrogation that could be used to make people talk against their will. Channeled through the Office of the Coordinator of Information is what came to be known as the TD, or Truth Drug Project. The Office of the Coordinator of Information would soon merge into the science-based Office of Strategic Services, or OSS, the clandestine wartime precursor to the CIA. These early truth drug experiments would be carried out in secret, but apparently with little success, under the cover that the OSS was attempting to find a cure for shell shock.
Some of the newer trends in the USSR are as follows. A. The adoption of a multidisciplinary approach, integrating biological, social, and physical mathematical research in attempts to better understand and eventually to control human behavior in a manner consonant with national plans.
But the computer continuously and instantly solves the problem and sends the answer to the guns as train and elevation orders.
In May 1942, just a few weeks before the OSS was officially created, a small invitation-only meeting was held on, quote, cerebral inhibition that would change everything. It centered around two topics, hypnosis and the conditioned reflex. The Josiah Macy Jr. Foundation, a private philanthropy tied to the Rockefeller oil empire and later outed as a CIA front during the MKUltra revelations in the 1970s, would host the meeting. Macy's Foundation president and neurologist Frank Fremont Smith, well-connected to an inner core of elite scientific operatives, brought together a cross-disciplinary panel of ranking academics deeply meshed within both the scientific agenda of the major private foundations and the wartime intelligence effort to weaponize science in light of technological advances. Off the record, these people would discuss what could be done about the problem. Chairman Warren S. McCullough, a neurophysiologist at the University of Illinois' Neuropsychiatric Institute, who fancied himself an investigative philosopher of the nervous system in relation to human consciousness.
Special stress is laid on a competent neurological examination.
His cybernetic quest to understand the brain-mind problem would come to be known as second-order cybernetics. Anthropologist Margaret Mead and her husband, social scientist Gregory Bateson, members of the Morale Committee, who would quickly become OSS agents, using foundation and military grants to study cultures at a distance, break down psychology of groups, and design black propaganda. And their upstairs neighbor, Macy's Vice President Lawrence K. Frank, who directed the Rockefeller Foundation Child Development Program and influenced behaviorist changes in public schools that would lead to the federal Head Start program. Physiologist Arturo Rosenbluth of Mexico City, who studied homeostasis and biological organisms under frequent Macy's Foundation collaborator Walter Buchanan. Rosenbluth's work with math prodigy Norbert Wiener was now on the verge of a breakthrough that would alter our society forever. And psychoanalyst Lawrence Kuby, another member of the Morale Committee who would carry out unethical truth drug research for the OSS alongside future MKUltra contractor George Hunter White.
This man worked on some of these programs. He would write of his work, "It was fun, fun, fun."
Kuby would later reflect on his experiments on prisoners with White, writing, "I look back fondly on those days. What great fun we had." Trained in psychiatry and later as an experimental neuropathologist at the elite Rockefeller Institute for Medical Research, Kuby studied under Penfield's mentor, Sir Sherrington at Oxford, where he developed a significant theory that neuroses escalate due to excitation waves that build up tension by cycling through closed loops in the nervous system. The leading topic at the 1942 Macy's Conference was the covert use of hypnosis, presented by FBI asset Milton H. Erickson, a pioneer of implanted hypnotic suggestion, who would later contract with both the OSS and CIA.
I understand you've never been hypnotized. Close your eyes. Take a deep breath. Let it seem to you as if many minutes had passed. And you're beginning to learn to go into a trance. That's right. That's right. I want you to go deeper and deeper into the trance.
Though there are no published records from this meeting, psychologist Lawrence Kuby, a key member of the Macy's Conference, wrote about their work together in his 1939 paper on experimental neurosis in man, where he explains how Erickson is able to implant false memories and hypnotic commands into subjects who later display the fearful symptoms of neurosis. Kuby describes how, quote, psychotic emotional storms could be triggered on command by hypnotic cues.
And you do not know the answer to that question consciously.
In an OSS plot to send coded messages through hypnotized couriers.
You can ask a subject to develop an amnesia for certain experiences, or certain classes of experiences, for certain attitudes, for certain learnings. Because in the hypnotic trance, then you need merely to direct the ideas to which the subject is to respond. Your unconscious mind can forget about it, you know. All you have to do is let things happen.
Hypnosis rolled over into the group's second presentation on the conditioned reflex, presented by psychologist Howard Liddell, who established Cornell University's Behavior Farm Laboratory, where irrational stimulus and response patterns were found to trigger artificial neurosis in sheep and other animals. A devotee of Russian physiologist Ivan Pavlov, Howard Liddell used the techniques of conditioned response that Pavlov had developed.
I'm myself somewhat of a disciple of Pavlov.
To study the conditions between the central nervous system and emotions. These experiments proved that motivations like hunger could be exploited, and the psychological response to stimulus, whether pain, fear, or reward, could be gamed to create experimentally induced neuroses, which is little different than torture. Like other Macy's attendees, Liddell had been recruited by the National Research Council, which had, with Macy's Foundation funding, formed a number of emergency committees, including a division of anthropology and psychology. It was in this spirit of marrying science and research to efforts in espionage that the meeting commenced. entangled in the secrecy and urgency of the war.
If you are working in a defense-related area, your plant must be a strong island of vigilance amid the potential security threats on every spot in our nation's defense against the spy.
But the most important conversation happened in the lunchroom when Arturo Rosenbluth told the other attendees about his work with math genius Norbert Wiener on so-called teleology and goal-seeking devices. As it turned out, the behavior of organisms and machines could be neatly and simply modeled around the feedback loop. Margaret Mead was so riveted that she chipped a tooth, though she didn't realize it until later. She said, recalling the meeting, it was 1942.
When you really had the design of what needed to be done.
Its members dispersed to tend to their roles of wartime scientific research, but the Macy's group would not end there. 10 more Macy's conferences were planned on what the group informally called the Man-Machine Project, a new science of control based largely on Norbert Wiener's work. During the First World War, Norbert Wiener studied artillery fire as a soldier and math expert with what was then primitive equipment.
1 to 4 bursts move along the course of your plane, keeping pace with you as the fire control instruments supply predicted firing data constantly. The targets sighted, direction, angular height, and altitude readings are taken at several points along its course.
By World War II, Norbert Wiener had automated anti-aircraft artillery fire, along with his partner, electrical engineer Julian Bigelow.
The anti-aircraft gunner cannot rely on dead reckoning. His leading must be a careful mathematical calculation.
It was one of the outstanding achievements of the war, improving accuracy to a science.
Whether tracked by optical sight or by radar, the information is fed by electric cable to a director.
And we now have the basic elements of a differential.
This mechanical quiz kid digests the data and automatically computes the right lead.
The other two parts then are inputs. The sum is 6 inches.
It used automatic tracking systems that would make decisions or adjustments based on the feedback of changes in course, speed, or wind.
So they will fire not at where the target is now, but at where it will be.
It was all negative feedback, really. The calculus of the space of what hadn't quite happened yet, like a duck hunter. Wiener's goal-seeking machines would lead the target and time the intersection of the bird and the shot. The potential maneuvers are weighed and considered, then done or not done or not done, like an arm extended to reach for a glass, moving exactly the distance needed in order to grasp it. Intricate activity in the nervous system carries out muscle contractions or muscle inhibitions countless times over, keeping the body on track to grab the water that the mind wants to drink. What if the brain worked like a computer? If so, could it be decoded and reprogrammed?
You could see from this that if you knew when to make changes and what changes to make, you could continuously defeat the predictions.
This rotund and notoriously absent-minded genius had constructed a formula for what he termed cybernetics, a phrase he had coined out of the Greek word kybernetes, or steersman. His 1948 book, underwritten by the Rockefeller Foundation and written primarily for trained scientists, summed up cybernetics as control and communication in the animal and the machine. Its popularity triggered the 1950 follow-up, The Human Use of Human Beings, Cybernetics and Society. Dropping the heavy math, it outlined a whole new era.
Our first assignment was communication, maintaining the nerve system of the arsenal of democracy. Communication.
It was during these interwar years and at a confidential meeting in Princeton that Warren McCullough, in his words, began conspiring with Rosenbluth and Fremont Smith on the interdisciplinary meetings to follow. By the time the Macy's Conference reformed in March of 1946, they knew, in principle at least, that the brain and the computer had a common link in their operating systems. Both work through inputs and outputs, so interface should theoretically be possible. Now, technology from the war had provided a unique opportunity for researching these questions in practical terms.
The outstanding feature, in addition to the interdisciplinary approach, is a new concern for mathematical approaches to an understanding of behavior. Particularly notable are attempts to use modern information theory, automata theory, and feedback concepts in interpreting the mechanisms by which the second signal system, i.e. speech and associated phenomena, affect human behavior.
The first official Macy's Cybernetics Conference was held in March 1946, just a few months before the passage of the National Mental Health Act, which gave the federal government a new mandate, not just to treat, but prevent mental illness, establishing the National Institute of Mental Health. Known during the first six meetings by the longer title, Circular Causal and Feedback Mechanisms in Biological and Social Systems, these cybernetic conferences combine the innovators of the physical and biological sciences with those of the psychological and social sciences to tackle the, quote, comprehensive study of man. Thus, the core Macy's group expanded to include Norbert Wiener, an MIT mathematics professor and child prodigy who earned his PhD from Harvard at age 17 and studied under mathematician and political philosopher Lord Bertrand Russell, author of the seminal book Establishing the Modern Rules of Logic. John von Neumann, the Hungarian émigré and member of the Manhattan Project, who had become a pioneer of the digital computer.
The electronic computer.
And who used game theory to analyze Cold War strategic thinking. MIT mathematician Walter Pitts.
Mathematics has been called the one universal language of mankind.
Who was self-taught in logic and co-authored several key papers on brain modeling with Warren McCullough. Rafael Lorente Dano of the Rockefeller Institute of Medical Research, who had obsessively chronicled the action potentials of neurons and noted their compatibility with electronic and digital systems. German emigre and Gestalt psychologist Heinrich Kluver, who studied visual perception, hallucinations, and mescaline as an experimental physiological psychologist, and was best known for Kluver-Busey syndrome, a cognitive impairment triggered by surgically created brain lesions. German refugee and Gestalt psychologist Kurt Lewin, an OSS agent and director of MIT's Center for Group Dynamics, who was closely associated with the Frankfurt School and Tavistock Institute. Editor of the Macy's Conferences, second-order cybernetician Heinz von Forrester ran the Pentagon-funded Biological Computer Laboratory at the University of Illinois. Born in Vienna and part of the infamous Vienna Circle, von Forrester studied physics and conducted radar experiments for the Nazis and subsequently the Allied occupation. McCullough arranged for his academic position, permanent stay, and invitation to the Macy's Conference in 1949 after reading his work on the molecular basis of memory as a function of quantum mechanics. Along with these key participants were about a dozen other core members, as well as a handful of invited guests drawn from key positions of expertise. Macy's guests included OSS and CIA asset psychiatrist Harold Abramson, who worked on top-secret chemical warfare projects at Fort Detrick, some of which were co-sponsored by the Macy's Foundation itself, and who had run multiple MKUltra projects involving LSD experimentation. Dr. Abramson is also known for introducing LSD to many of the Macy's Conference attendees, including Macy's President Frank Fremont Smith and Gregory Bateson.
That's acid.
Acid!
The attendees gathered together for 2 days at the Beekman Hotel, today a white glove luxury condominium on the Upper East Side of Manhattan. The posh neighborhood may have seemed like an unlikely location, but not only was it next door to the Macy's Foundation, it was also just a few blocks away from the Council on Foreign Relations, which Alan Dulles had led for decades, and from the Rockefeller Institute for Medical Research and Cornell Medical College, where Project MKUltra research funds were channeled into the Human Ecology Fund. Rather than be based out of Washington, D.C., the wartime OSS operated out of its headquarters in room 3603 of Rockefeller Center, working side by side with Britain's MI6 and in the same building as the Rockefeller Foundation.
This machine has stored program, and that is the thing which makes the computer revolution possible.
John von Neumann took the stage to update everyone on the progress of the digital computer during the war.
The immense strides in computer technology that were spurred by von Neumann's work.
It was now ready for the next stage of exploitation.
The system calls for the key to be either up or down. The code calls for a dot or a dash.
Norbert Wiener's cybernetic concept held the key as to what they should do with the digital computers they had developed.
The method and the signal are such that they must be fed to the transmitter in a series of positive decisions.
It fused together the working principles of the biological organism, looping systems that maintained equilibrium.
Its maintenance is automatic and seeks to balance any disturbances.
Wiener, Rosenbluth, and Bigelow presented the ideas of their paper, Behavior, Teleology, and Purpose. It was written in 43, but couldn't be published until 1947 due to secrecy. They had a universal mechanism to create goal-seeking behavior that made machines and even people basically programmable. On the influence of a feedback system, Wiener stated,
"The existing natural reflexes are essentially part of the same mechanism that can inform all purposeful activity in automata. One need merely supply a circuit with receptors and effectors. Then they become goal-seeking devices."
Conference Chairman Warren McCullough had taken things a step further, showing how the operation of the human brain can be represented by on and off electric switching devices.
It is stop or go, on or off, one or none.
His 1943 paper with Walter Pitts on the logical calculus of neuronal activity introduced the concept of the neural net and showed how the communication of neurons could be modeled by a digital computer.
The mind, in contradistinction to brain and behavior, emerged in the 1950s as a legitimate object of experimental research. The neural nets project of McCullough and Pitts spearheaded this cognitivist turn in the 1940s. Science of mind thus became a science of signals based on binary logic. Neural nets bridge the gulf between body and mind, matter and form.
The comparisons between the central nervous system as an electronic machine and the digital computer as an artificial brain boil down to questions of logic, mathematics, and the very nature of reality itself.
Very simply, in the first place, I wanted to find out what was going in the brain.
For McCullough, it was always an esoteric quest to find the nature of reality in quantifiable and technical terms.
Head of the Department of Cybernetics at MIT, psychologist, psychiatrist, neurophysiologist, engineer, mathematician, American, a confirmed eccentric, a genuine Renaissance man.
The first answers to his questions came during the tail end of World War I. Yale's wartime ROTC training instructor in chemical warfare was none other than Professor
Bertram Borden Boltwood, head of the chemistry department and an expert in chemical warfare.
Boltwood, who'd come from a wealthy family of skull and bones initiates, was on the front lines of discovering the inner world of the atom and the first to discover evidence of radioactive decay of uranium in lead. A chosen initiate, Professor Boltwood invited young McCullough to his home to discuss the hidden history of science from its mysterious beginnings.
It was just before the Great War ended that he invited me to his home for an uninterrupted talk. He complained to me of his increasing forgetfulness and asked me to spend one evening, 5 p.m. to 5 a.m., with him to illuminate the larger picture. He grabbed me by the hands and intently revealed to me the hidden history of science from its mysterious beginnings.
Knowledge was passed down through the centuries and closely guarded by the initiates.
Between ancient Egypt, Mesopotamia, the Phoenicians, Babylonia, and beyond,
all shared the mysterious keys to governing early civilizations.
Cybernetic at heart, these inherited secrets fueled the minds of the ancient philosophers and mathematicians.
Thereafter, priest classes, secret societies, and elite organizations of learned men.
After summing up this history of scientific progress, he paused. The room went silent. And he said, "If you want to get behind the fake explanation of how our world comes to be as it is, then you must find the facts for yourself and accept nothing in addition but logic and mathematics."
In an interview years later with counterculture icon Stuart Brand, Margaret Mead and Gregory Bateson admitted that McCullough constructed the meetings around a, quote, grand design, shaping who would speak and in what order over a five-year period. When Brand asked Bateson what McCullough's grand strategy was, Bateson simply replied, "Who knows?" What was the common code between the communication of the nervous system and the computer's binary processing language? They wanted to show the effect of the physical world on the mind in statistical terms or data. Input, output. Eventually, all the entities will sync to the dominant, whichever is making the most accurate and reliable long-term decisions, whoever is setting the pace and the trends, which could carry out any number of simultaneous calculations and feed back into the mental loop.
Implied by this research was the hope for a technology for controlling behavior via the second signal system, using information inputs as causative agents rather than chemical agents, electrodes, or other more exotic techniques applicable perhaps to individuals rather than groups. See, this new trend, observed in the early post-Stalin period, continues. By 1960, the word cybernetics was used by the Soviets to designate this new trend. This new science is considered by some as the key to understanding the human brain and the product of its functioning, psychic activity and personality, to the development of means for controlling it, and to ways for molding the character of the new communist man.
The airborne computer is no longer a theory, nor an experiment. It's a fact. Tested, functioning, practical, and restricted. It has gone into production under the label Brain.
Macy's was meshing the power of language, communication, and the symbolic exchange of information with the biological modes of control, sowing seeds in a thousand directions.
A psychologist was involved in this experiment, along with a biophysicist and a physiologist.
This was the birth of personal computers, robotics, satellites, and artificial intelligence. From the very beginning, models created in the digital computer of the brain were also inversely symbolic of the mechanization of the mind, which might one day be conquered one neuron at a time.
As he finds the correct path, he registers the information in his memory. Thesus is an electrically controlled mouse. He has the ability to solve problems by trial and error means and then remember the solution. And something perhaps akin to a brain.
a counterpart to Macy's. The Ratio Club was formed in 1949 in the UK. McCullough gave the keynote at the first meeting. Alan Turing, W. Ross Ashby, Gray Walter, and Donald McKay were among its most important members.
Now meet Dr. Gray Walter of Bristol. His mechanical tortoise has an electronic brain which functions like the human mind. Sensitive to both light and touch, Dr. Walter says that his electronic toys work exactly as though they have a simple two-cell nervous system, and that with more cells, they could do many more tricks.
But Gray Walter was more deeply involved in the study of brainwave activity itself.
Present-day radio and television techniques afford an opportunity to probe into the brain.
Mapping the relaxed states of mind characterized by alpha waves, and Walter was the first to experimentally produce changes in brain waves through the use of flickering light.
Now I'm going to flash a bright light at you. Keep your eyes closed, and please try not to move. That's good.
Gray Walter had also worked closely with Norbert Wiener, introducing him in the early 30s to the then mysterious field of brainwave interpretation.
For each stimulus to a sense organ starts not one, but a train of impulses which are easily followed electrically with a cathode ray or other oscillograph.
The discussion began at von Neumann's request, a conversation about consciousness as to whether there is an anatomical substrate for what has everybody knowing things. Von Bonnen held it was probably not cerebral cortex that determined awareness, but more likely something in the midbrain. And I suggested the importance of the thalamus. Fremont Smith went into the different degrees of consciousness from full attention through twilight states to sleep and hysterical amnesias. Molly Hauer described the stimulation of the cortex she witnessed under Dr. Penfield, which did not disturb the patients, yet threw them into a panic when stimulation caused vocalization resembling speech. The distinction between consciousness and awareness.
Members of the Macy's conferences, including Frank Fremont Smith, Margaret Mead, Clyde Cluckholm, Henry W. Brosen, and Molly Harwer, also sat on the governing board of the International Committee on Mental Hygiene.
Oh my God. Oh no, don't let them take me in there.
Headed by John Rawlings Rees, creator of the Rockefeller Foundation-funded Tavistock Institute and the British Army's chief psych warfare expert during World War II. Mental hygiene went global, and a massive conference was convened in London in 1948.
Can serve as a springboard for more meaningful discussion, I think, about the nature of the problem.
To mold the post-war New World man, starting inside his own head.
Because it enables the individual to fit into an orderly system. Being a member of an organized group offers a basis for emotional stability to every man.
Heavily funded by the British and American governments and the private philanthropic foundations, it almost seemed like a global Manhattan Project for the mind was kicking off.
We all have our problems. You've got to pull yourself together, and this will all work out all right.
It culminated in a report authored by the Cybernetics Conference members, Lawrence Frank and Margaret Mead, and was titled Mental Health and World Citizenship, which focused on the modifiability of man and all of his social institutions.
They come from all sorts of homes, these patients, all kinds of backgrounds. But somewhere along the line, life became too much for them.
Political, economic, legal, and religious. His family, his school, and his workplace.
How wrong I was. Or no, not wrong, sick. And now that I'm well again, I can't help feeling just a little sad, the way you always do.
In order to influence and change the world's behavior, one human being at a time. It stated, quote, "The sciences of man offer the hope of a new approach to the problem of war and a world community, and it is the ultimate goal of mental health to help men to live with their fellows in one world so that men can live together in peace with each other.
Reinforced shock treatment helped Fred to draw away from his feelings of antagonism and suspicion and move closer to reality.
Because of this, they determine, quote, the goal of mental health has been enlarged from a concern about the development of healthy personalities to the larger task of creating a healthy society.
But whatever the mode of treatment, it's essential that it be supplemented by an atmosphere of security and calm. The effective hospital must always serve as a refuge for its patients, a place where they can live quietly during that period of reorientation in which they learn how to achieve a better adjustment to the world outside.
Out of the conference, a supposedly scientific World Federation of Mental Health was established. John Rawlings Rees left the Tavistock Institute to become its first president, a seat that both Fremont Smith and Meade would later fill as well. The group's motto, borrowed from the UNESCO Constitution, was, quote, since wars begin in the minds of men, it is in the minds of men that the defenses of peace must be constructed.
The problem became one of communication between man and machine, between machine and machine, between machine and man.
There was a large military presence at the Macy's cybernetic meetings, perhaps not surprising given how many contracts its core members had with Naval, Air Force, and Army research, all of which were later exposed as routine fronts for CIA endeavors.
These meetings bring together field representatives, simulation data people with their background of environmental information, and military personnel, the ultimate users of the programs.
The Office of Naval Research had its own branch for investigating physiological psychology, basically another name for cybernetics.
Man, which we have put in between two already known machines. Man is a predictor and says, I shall continue to do whatever my last solution predicted will be right, so long as no detectable difference arises. I'm very curious to know just how far we can push this human operator.
Would you please describe?
In which part of the brain should they screw the spark plug? So we have the human operator surrounded on both sides by very precisely known mechanisms, and the question comes up, what kind of a machine have we placed in the middle? What kind of a machine is man?
The needs that power the human machine, that influence human behavior. Let's take a man. Any man.
Man, the maker. Tools would give him control over his own world, organization, and extension, using strategy for dominance and survival.
You see, in the chain, the end man sends a message and then he has nothing else to do. He merely waits for the answer to come back.
Man splits into groups, tribes, cults of information, and behavior propagated through rituals.
The number of messages sent, of course, correlates highly with where you are in the group.
Clusters of knowledge, careful note of mysteries and breakthroughs, spilling forth in useful language, not open source, but guarded secrets of power.
If we play this game on paper, we get almost exactly the operation one gets with an actual group.
The modification of the synapse. Neurons that fire together, wire together. Hebb proved that.
I would like to follow that remark. When we were talking this morning, von Neumann was saying that the brain could not be an analog calculating machine, but must be a digital one.
A machine with an analogic part and a digital part.
So the analog part is able to create analogies that mirror observed actions in human beings with whom we communicate.
Such a device may also use data from previous experience to predict the future.
A tapestry woven from the memories of past sensations.
What am I hearing? I can't tell where this
that
is going.
That depends on where you walk to.
Curiouser and curiouser. What kind of place is this?
What I see when I look at you is, in fact, my image of you. Or you see your image of me. The how of using our senses is a deeply concealed body of knowledge. Very few people seem to realize the enormous theoretical power of this distinction between what I see and what is actually out there. Most assume that they see what they look at, but the map is not the territory. What gets from the territory to the map, i.e., from the outside world to the brain, is news of difference, motion, for instance. If there is no difference in the territory, there's nothing to say on the map.
After creating his neural nets model with Pitts, the McCullough's MIT team would write, "What the frog's eye tells the brain, perception. Our brains translated and converted analog symbols embedded in our sense receptors into digital data in our brain. It isn't reality that we see, but rods and cones interpreting the shapes and shadows and colors of the real world. For frogs, it meant an eye trained to see primarily flies and bugs, a worldview that was easily tricked and fooled by forms and puppets and other forgeries. Human senses were tricked by many things in the labs, along with practically every other animal species that had been tested."
"Why do the two heads seem to change size? Answer, the windows are distorted."
Plato's famous allegory of the cave. Reality is nothing more than shadow puppets projected on cave walls.
It goes all the way around. It's an optical illusion.
But even though you tell me, my eyes still won't believe it.
When you run circles around the military's technologically driven future, the nerves of the Army and Navy and Air Force, the communication networks of signals and intercepts of planes, tanks, boats, missiles, and torpedoes, when you run circles around the whole of human society and its various cycles of influence and modification, and when you run circles around the individual, circles around the problem of the machine and man himself. And once you go around and around the problem of feedback and the cycles of behavior, the responses of Pavlovian conditioning, perception and reality, in the end, the whole of man can be controlled through his dependence on his environment. Because the mind is contained within the brain-body mechanism, and thus isolated from the outside world, it is entirely dependent upon information derived from the senses. In other words, the mind is already contained within a natural matrix.
Focused on communication, their main purpose of indicating to what extent science suffers from the babble of its many tongues, and hence how necessary it is for us to learn to speak again to one another.
Many of the cybernetics members were now talking literally about constructing an artificial matrix.
A matrix is supposed to give birth, not receive. And yet what I want to talk about is very definitely the birth of a matrix. The matrix has been a growing thing, getting more and more complex, wider and wider in its scope, and, I believe, more and more fertile as time has gone on.
Pattern comes from pater, the father, yeah? A stamp, then the papa is making again and again children of himself. What is a complementary to pattern?
Uh-huh.
It's a matrix. Yeah? Look at the matrix which embeds.
Yes.
So everything is sitting in one big thing embedded in a matrix.
As Alex Bavelis of MIT noted in his group dynamics studies,
We are attempting now to describe the operation of a net in terms of the probability that there will be a message from A to B in a given time period. We plot the net as a matrix. We put ones where there is a link, and zeros where there is no direct link.
At stake was the unveiling of an entirely new paradigm, one which encompassed a holistic view of control that could potentially govern the world and the mind. The system they came up with required that individuals and society be placed in a common communications network.
The eye of the beholder sees a strange new technology.
It all centered around man-computer symbiosis.
Things are going to be considerably better for a lot of people when and if we ever get changed over to an essentially electronic base.
As this network evolved, the internet developed into an artificial nervous system. Like other Macy's attendees, J.C.R. Licklider had been activated by wartime research. His experiments in modeling the human brain with psychoacoustic factors at Harvard overlapped with secretive contract work that revolved around how the human nervous system reacted to electronic stimuli.
Behavior tied to appetite was couched in the same terms as that for self-steering torpedoes and self-training guns.
Like so many computers, machines, and other controllable factors, man could be placed in a technical loop and his behavior modified.
Yes, I see. Do go on.
A psychologist and computer scientist, Licklider embodied the connection between cybernetics and Cold War air defense, which was largely based out of Boston and MIT. His presence at the 1950 Macy's Cybernetic Meeting coincided with his move to MIT and the start of a pivotal but shadowy role in creating the militarized MIT Lincoln Laboratory, the SAGE radar network, and the DEW Line, or Distant Early Warning Missile Defense System.
A radar early warning line north.
A system which relied upon the very command and control communication networks that Norbert Wiener and others at Macy's created. Ultimately, the nerves of the nation's defense were designed to operate like the human nervous system.
And so headquarters, United States Air Force, arrived at a command and control concept with data processing as its nerve center. Its basic function, to extend the useful capacity of man's brain.
Switched to digital communication technology, aided and abetted by satellites. The melding of computers and communication.
A fact which influenced Licklider's vision for a networked and interconnected society.
And then to interconnect each of the computers to each other to form a fully connected network.
That would eventually culminate in the DARPA-created ARPANET, the forerunner to the modern internet.
Research now going on will someday permit a network user to log in.
The important thing to realize about systems is how they are controlled. And we must get rid of any notion straight away that control is something imposed on the system from outside. It has to be built into it. Let's see how the mechanism works. You see it lifting here, transmitting the message along here, lifting that cam up here, and then shutting off a valve there. That is built into the system. It's called feedback, and feedback is ubiquitous in control systems.
At this point, we realize that reality itself is not a fixed thing. As our nervous systems interpret the symbols and signals of familiar patterns and changes, continuously revising our image of the world. Thus, an artificial matrix is inherent, indeed unavoidable.
These systems which are minds are circuits of cause and effect. They are cybernetic systems. For me, the system is man and environment.
Man sought to control his own kind by way of understanding what governed his actions, starting with the neuron, base unit of mind-body communication.
What is cybernetics? A railway train needs no steering gear. The forces required to correct for the buffetings of wind and way are supplied automatically by sideways reaction of the rails against the wheel flanges. A ship, lacking such implicit means of guidance, requires a helm, normally controlled by a helmsman. The Latin for helmsman is jubinator. The Greek, kybernetes. From the first comes our word cybernetics, la cybernétique, to denote the science of government.
In the end, cybernetic modification of the human being makes information and its communication the key to control, making reality itself malleable, and our interaction with the technology at hand has created its own feedback derived from our interpreted reality.
The world about us is accessible only through a nervous system, and that our information concerning it is confined to what limited information the nervous system can transmit.
As this technology captures, measures, and analyzes the world around us, man is programmed and reprogrammed through continuous updates provided by this intermediary. And conditioning comes with it, along with new reflexes.
And, specifically, it is a recursive epistemology, and based upon recursiveness of cycles, returning all the time to bite their own beginnings.
Cybernetics programmed in this same base human language, self-reflexive cycles, feedback and adaptation. Our very essence is conflicted with the environment and yet dependent upon interacting within it.
Yet the old worm Ouroboros is an odd worm who conceals not only his recursive nature, but also the implications of recursiveness.
The Ouroboros is the perfect symbol for Kubernetes.
Ultimately, the underlying natural matrix is supplanted by an artificial one. Born with the collective consciousness of mankind's total intent, goals, and purpose. Ultimately, they found that programming was easy. Easy enough, anyway. The science of cybernetics would reveal to the CIA, or any serious agency making inquiries, that although the mind itself could not be directly controlled, it was, in essence, malleable due to its reliance upon physical sense data and man's unique ability to comprehend language and to talk. Behavior, then, modified by continuous feedback, was inherent in communication itself. The ultimate question was, who or what would control the signal? Reports from the first 5 of the 10 Macy's Cybernetics conferences were never publicly released. These 10 meetings systematically worked out questions of control that would have to be asked and could only be answered through experimentation, some of which would prove so unethical it could only be carried out under a blanket of national security on a need-to-know basis. The last cybernetics meeting was held April 22, 1953. Just 9 days after Alan Dulles signed off on MKUltra. Norbert Wiener lamented,
"Those of us who have contributed to the new science of cybernetics thus stand in a moral position, which is to say the least not very comfortable. We have contributed to the initiation of a new science which embraces technological developments with great possibilities for good and evil."
This was especially so, since the computing machine had already reached a point of such complexity that it threatened man's freedom to make individual decisions.
"We do not have a choice in suppressing these new technological developments. We can only hand it over to the world that exists about us. There are those who hope for the good of a better understanding of man and society that may anticipate and outweigh the incidental contribution we are making to the concentration of power. I am compelled to say that it is a very slight hope.
Of military and technological development in our century leaves no margin for guesswork, no time for the leisurely trial and error of yesterday.
Cyber evolved beyond the passive reception of one-way signals. As with television, instead it required a feedback loop of interaction.
Would you advocate a world ruled by scientists and by the super brains?
No.
We are fit for discovering how the world works. We're not fit for telling other people what to do.
At a conference in 1968, shortly before his death, Warren McCullough remarked, "Man, to my mind, is about the nastiest, most destructive of all the animals. And I don't see any reason, if he can evolve machines that can have more fun than he himself can, why shouldn't they take over, enslave us, quite happily?"
We used to argue about whether a computer can think. The answer is no. What thinks is a total circuit, including perhaps a computer, a man, and an environment.
If you could control the environment,
all of the circumstances to which the individual must react to the environment in which he lives.
Similarly, we may ask whether a brain can think, and again, the answer is no.
He has to work by cycles of operation, very much like an ordinary mechanical computer. He does very many complicated things.
What thinks is a brain inside a man who is part of a system which includes an environment.
If you can get to the man at the switches, then you can get to the real man.
Scientists are not interested in controlling other people. They're interested in finding out how the world really works. Now, look, I'm not even able to run a gang of 20 people, and I've had 50 under me. No. To run the world, no. No scientist is fit for that.
As one Soviet author puts it, cybernetics can be used in molding of a child's character, the inculcation of knowledge and techniques, the amassing of experience, the establishment of social behavior patterns, all functions which can be summarized as control of the growth process of the individual. Students of particular disciplines in the USSR, such as psychologists and social scientists, also support the general cybernetic trend.
Viewing the MKUltra subprojects again through the lens of these new cybernetic models of man and his mind, we find elements of the Macy's conferences woven into the agency's unethical experiments to control human beings throughout the Cold War. Case in point is Subproject 119. Its admitted aim was an interpretive survey of work being done in psychophysiological research and instrumentation, with five goals stated simply by order of operations. A. Bioelectric sensors, sources of significant electrical potential and methods of pickup. B. Recording, amplification, electronic tape, and other multi-channel recording. C. Analysis, autocorrelators, spectrum analyzers, etc., and coordination with automatic data processing equipment. D. Standardization of data for correlation with biochemical, physiological, and behavioral indices. And once they had all that figured out, E. Techniques of activation of the human organism by remote electronic means. Time revealed the principal on Subproject 119 was Dr. Saul B. Sells, who moved to Texas Christian University after spending a decade with the Air Force School of Aviation Medicine at Randolph Field and working as a statistician for the government during World War II. Sells specialized in crunching data to extract patterns and insights about behavior. Founding the Institute of Behavior Research at TCU, he tabulated the importance of hundreds of factors and environmental conditions that trigger man's predictive behavior. Along with the Air Force and NASA, Sells spent decades quietly carrying out various research projects for the Office of Naval Research, which even sponsored a symposium at TCU with Sells and fellow MKUltra-funded researcher Muzaffar Sharif on the stimulus determinants of behavior in 1961. One of Sells' first projects at TCU in 1959 was to send a proposal to the CIA regarding psychophysiological research to investigate electrical signals from the human brain and other systems, and the development of a more advanced multi-channel electronic analyzer to interpret those signals. The CIA responded to these objectives, which it discussed at some length with Sells, before appointing him as a supposedly unwitting participant in charge of MKUltra Subproject 119. The work lasted almost 6 years through 1965, and was funneled through the Society for the Investigation of Human Ecology. Later exposed as a CIA front run by Harold G. Wolf and Lawrence Hinkle out of Cornell Medical Institute, right across the street from the Rockefeller Institute for Medical Research on the Upper East Side of Manhattan.
Okay, this is their perception of it, if I could
no,
just continue.
No, it wasn't their perception of it either. No, it wasn't.
Dangerous to his being, contrary
yeah,
to any previous
that,
consciously expressed
see,
intentions and interests, contrary to the good of the individual, and subversive to the goals for which he is consciously working.
Yeah, I understand
working.
All this talk. But the situation was, you see, those things were never done because of wise people on both sides. We not able to do this and are interested in it.
They were, though.
Some of the low-level people were, but the high-level people were not, to tell you the truth.
The bioelectronics directories the CIA commissioned Sells to compile included a detailed Rolodex of invasive neurological research projects at countless institutions being carried out by countless professionals. And yet the names that come up again and again reveal what a small world it really is. Not to mention multiple scientists who were later exposed as running their own MKUltra subprojects. What did 119 really mean by techniques of activation of the human organism by remote electronic means? Neither the declassified documents nor any of the government hearings throughout the 70s ever followed up on what the real goal of this subproject was. Dr. Jose Delgado is a good place to start. His name appears at least a dozen times in Saul Sells' bioelectronic directories. The general public is more familiar with Delgado's experiments than nearly any other that has been connected to the CIA's secretive MKUltra objectives.
Here we see the normal, highly aggressive behavior of a healthy bull in a small bull ring.
For the scientists who were attempting to decode the central nervous system, Electrical stimulation of the brain became a natural extension of the original experiments with electricity that Galvani, Volta, and others had used to trigger muscle contractions in frogs at the tail end of the 18th century. By the time Dr. Jose Delgado stepped into the ring, he didn't need the customary red cape anymore. Only a remote control.
Neurophysicist Dr. Jose Delgado was financed by the Office of Naval Research.
Delgado had implanted a series of electrodes into the aggression center of a bull's brain. And then he invited the press.
The electrodes are attached to a small transistorized electrical stimulator, which is cemented to the bull's skull. The electrical stimulator in the skull responds to radio stimulation, so the bull is literally subject to remote control.
Delgado has remote control of the animal.
When the remote control apparatus is operated and the bull's caudate nucleus is stimulated, the bull becomes non-aggressive.
Stopping the charging animal now only required the push of a button.
According to Marcuse, inner freedom designates the private space in which man may become and remain himself. Today, this private space has been invaded and whittled down by technological reality.
The techno-matador spectacle, which made headline upon controversial headline in 1966, was meant to shock people, to put humans in their place. But at this point in his career, Dr. Delgado was just showing off his ability to remote control the bull. He had been implanting electrodes in different centers of the brain since the early 1950s. By demonstrating that he could turn a bull on and off like a toy, and what observers could have been forgiven for mistaking as high-tech voodoo, Delgado apparently fancied himself the ultimate matador.
Recently released CIA documents refer to the feasibility of remote control of animals, and that special investigations will be conducted toward the application of selected elements of these techniques to man.
But the good doctor was only one of a network of neurophysiologists and psychiatrists running parallel research programs across the U.S. and the world. Cybernetician Warren McCullough was also among the earliest pioneers of deep electrode stimulation in the 30s at the Yale Laboratory of Neurophysiology, establishing the profound connection between the thalamus buried inside the brain and the outer sensory cortex that Wilder Penfield first explored.
The master control for the whole body resides in the brain, and the new methodology of implanted electrodes has provided direct access to the centers which regulate most of the body's activities.
But by the end of the half-century mark, things were honed into an operable science, and McGill would once again prove to be groundbreaking in decoding the inner brain. While Professor Donald Hebb was busy exploring the mechanisms of neural networks and the effects of isolation upon the mind, in part for the CIA, his postdoctoral students James Olds and Peter Milner were stumbling upon their own findings, which would prove to be pivotal. Although it had been accidental at first, Olds and Milner had discovered the so-called pleasure center of the brain through an extension of the technique Wilder Penfield first developed.
A new window on the brain was opened in 1953 when a rat fortuitously evidenced a neuro-rewarding effect. By returning to the place where he had been when an electrical stimulus was applied to the brain via chronically implanted electrodes.
In terms of conditioned behavior, this electrically induced reward became an end unto itself. In 1954, Olds created a reward map of the brain featuring locations where electrical stimulation caused mammals to come back for more. The reward map held true for rats, cats, monkeys, and humans. By 1961, James Olds, who'd been attending Macy's sister conferences on the central nervous system during the late 50s alongside Frank Fremont Smith, Howard Liddell, and other cybernetics acolytes, made history after he implanted an electrode into the pleasure center of a lab rat's brain and conditioned it to trigger its own self-satisfying electrical stimulation.
This is a device which trains the animal to turn on the stimulus for himself. Here you notice the animal wandering toward the pedal. When he first touches it, he gets no stimulation. It's not connected yet.
By pressing a simple lever.
Then one time he touches the pedal, it does turn on the stimulation. You can see the lights go on.
Within this cybernetic loop of electric stimulus and reward, Olds and Milner's experimental rats quickly succumbed to self-stimulating their own brains repeatedly, thousands of times, foregoing their own natural drives for hunger, sex, and even willingly enduring immense pain.
Now, I will electrify the grid. The animal must cross an area that gives a very painful shock to the feet in order to get to the pedal and stimulate the brain.
Rats implanted with these electrodes continued to push and push and push the lever again and again and again, even until the point of death, just to receive this stimulating electrical reward. Clearly, these researchers had uncovered something with far-reaching implications.
This shows a rat is willing to pay a very high price in order to get to the pedal.
In 1953, this series of therapeutic research experiments was conducted by Dr. Robert Heath of Tulane University. His subjects responded to electrical stimulation of isolated brain centers implanted with electrodes. We see here the possibility for direct physical manipulation of the mind and personality.
Feel good, do you think? Or if you do it too much, does it have any bad effects on you?
No bad effects at all.
Most of the scientists who conduct these experiments say that because they do not yet understand enough about the brain, these techniques should not be used on humans. But this man says they should. He is Dr. Robert Heath of Tulane University Medical School in New Orleans.
Famously, he claims to have turned down the CIA when the agency approached him about conducting covert research into the pain and pleasure centers of the brain. Reportedly offended at the abhorrent suggestion, he was quoted in dozens of papers as saying,
"I took the stand that if I wanted to be a spy, I'd be a spy. I wanted to be a doctor and practice medicine."
But in reality, Dr. Robert G. Heath had been investigating the effects of mind-altering surgeries and substances for the government since at least 1943, when as a military psychiatrist and chief resident at the Neurological Institute in New York tied to Columbia University, he performed experimental leucotomies and tested ergotamine tartrate, a precursor to LSD derived from ergot, on war-weary, psychologically stressed merchant marines. Curiously, despite the fact that practically nothing has been mentioned about it since, the press billed the experimental ergot treatment as a miracle cure for shell shock that could permanently relieve symptoms in a mere 2 hours. By 1949, Dr. Heath was made head of Tulane's newly created neurology and psychiatry department, and while the exact relationship remains unclear at this point, what is clear is that sometime during the early days of the CIA and military prodding into mind control through top-secret projects like Bluebird, Artichoke, and Chatter, Dr. Robert Heath was again tapped to go further than ever before in testing LSD, mescaline, and other mind-altering chemicals on his human patients. Dr. Heath carried out his research in the name of battling schizophrenia and mental disorders, which afforded him an endless supply of human test subjects. From the Tulane Medical School where he housed his labs, from the imposing charity hospital across the street, from the remote East Louisiana State Hospital hours away in rural Jackson, and even from the notorious Alcatraz of the South, Angola Prison. Because existing treatments had failed these patients, almost any experimental technique could be justified in their cases, although there is little evidence that Heath's experiments were actually therapeutic. By 1952, Dr. Heath had already outfitted nearly 24 mental patients with semi-permanent electrodes in their brains.
Yeah. I just feel like I don't have any thoughts like a human being. I'm just an animal walking around on the earth. Please don't do me like this. Please don't. I can't stand it. I don't like to feel like this.
Look at that smile you got now.
Why does that make me do that? I don't like to do that.
You really told me off, remember?
I know I did, but I couldn't help it.
In spite of all this, Heath's results were promising, at least to the intelligence community, anyway. A 1954 volume published through Harvard Press with funding from the Commonwealth Fund, later revealed as a CIA cutout, included details about Heath's research presented at a symposium which attracted participation from other notables in the field. That same year, Dr. Heath was invited to Edgewood Arsenal, where he was the keynote speaker at an Army Chemical Corps event and discussed the progression of his work with electrical stimulation and recording in the brain of man. Perhaps not so coincidentally, Tulane University reportedly signed off on a facility security clearance for Heath's entire department afterwards.
Other Army experiments continued on mental patients around the country. Work done at the Tulane Medical Center in New Orleans involved several drugs, hallucinogenics, and electrodes implanted in the brain.
FOIA documents would later reveal that Heath also took a CIA contract in 1955 to study the effects of the drug bulbocapnine, allegedly being tested by the Soviets to induce stupor and break willpower. For his test subjects, Heath pulled a couple of otherwise healthy prisoners from Angola. The bulk of Dr. Heath's work and of the resources of Tulane Medical School were not just focused on the testing of drugs, but the altering of human behavior. This took on a decided focus with Dr. Heath's obsession over the septal area, a rather pliable part of the limbic system near the amygdala, where he believed schizophrenics may have had an imbalance, and where he found excitatory pleasure and inhibitory pain could be systematically elicited on an electrode's command.
Now, as a patient at a New Orleans hospital, he has had electrodes implanted deep within his brain for a year and a half. In that time, he has been given a new personality.
Dr. Heath paralleled in the human mind the old concept of the self-stimulating rat, in some cases turning over the control to his electrode-implanted mental patients.
Dr. Heath inserted electrodes in the region of her brain he thought might be associated with pleasure.
Who quickly learned that they could mitigate pain or induce a deep-seated pleasure or even sexual arousal with the push of a button.
Find this button, this.
That's number two button.
Most pleasurable.
How do you feel? You're trying to tell me how it excites you, is that it?
Well, I think it's somewhat of a sexy button.
Down long Louisiana roads, boiling hot in the summer heat. On the path to remote mental wards and prisons, the ethical dilemmas were beyond blatant. Hospital administrators and wardens proved all too willing to give access for human experimentation that would have been unacceptable not just under the Nuremberg Codes, but standard American practice at the time. Dr. Heath also notoriously attempted to convert a homosexual man using brain stimulation to trigger his sexual centers in the presence of a female prostitute. Despite the highly publicized claim that he didn't want to be a spy, Dr. Heath was also attending symposiums on topics such as hallucinations, among many who would later be exposed as MK-Ultra subproject heads, including Dr. Maitland Baldwin of Subproject 62, Dr. Martin Orne of Subproject 84, and Dr. Louis Jolyon West of Subproject 43.
There's no way that I can see that it could be abused or misused. The control is in his hands.
But some people fear that the control won't stay in the patient's hands, that electrical stimulation could be used to manipulate people rather than to treat mental illness.
By placing electrodes deep within the brain, investigators, including Dr. Jose Delgado of Yale University, have located precise regions that activate emotions such as fear and rage, and basic drives such as hunger and sex. Electrodes can carry currents into the brain and allow the scientists to control behavior.
By the end of the 50s, the art of brain stimulation had advanced from long, conspicuous wire leads to more discreet remote control technology, and Delgado had virtually mastered an elaborate program of behavior modifications which he demonstrated in his monkeys.
The motor cortex is probably like a large keyboard, able to play the strings of muscular contraction and to produce movements.
In his Yale laboratory, Dr. Delgado has gone even further.
By pushing a button, he controls life in a colony of monkeys. He can direct their behavior and change the neatly ordered structure of their society.
Delgado could turn everything from emotions to actions on and off like a light switch. Flipping it on, Delgado could, for example, adjust the diameter of a monkey's pupil as if it were the iris of a camera, constricting one eye and dilating the other with great precision by varying signal strength sent to the hypothalamus. Anger, arousal, fear, or sleep could be dialed up just as easily. He called his device a stimoceiver.
We are used to the idea that machines can be controlled from a distance by means of radio signals. Garage doors can be opened or closed. Channels and volume of a TV set can be adjusted from an armchair. Even orbiting capsules can be directed from tracking stations on Earth. But perhaps it is still surprising to learn that we may also control the biological functions of living organisms from a distance.
Newspapers both repulsed and gripped the public with just how much control a little electricity had upon the brain. Dr. Delgado found his stimoceivers could even induce mothers to ignore their young on command. The electrode signals were so compelling and so precise, in fact, that Delgado was able to reliably provoke a single monkey into carrying out a complex series of 12 actions that led to attacking a rival monkey. When a computer-programmed signal was sent to the monkey's stimoceiver, the monkey predictably carried out the same sequence of actions in the exact same order every single time, 20,000 times in a row.
Cats, monkeys, or human beings can be induced to flex a limb, to reject food, or to feel emotional excitement under the influence of electrical impulses reaching the depths of their brains through radio waves purposely sent by an investigator.
Just to make a point, Delgado also turned the controls over to the colony as well, and the normally subservient monkeys were able to push a button and suppress the aggression of the most dominant one, and freely roam around his territory and even mock him to his face, demonstrating that brain stimulation could upend order in the primate world. But of course, Delgado's ambitions weren't ultimately focused just on the primate world.
But when violence strikes, then those in public responsibility have an immediate and a very different job, not to analyze, but to end disorder. $200 million Americans did not strike down Robert Kennedy last night, any more than they struck down President John F. Kennedy in 1963, or Dr. Martin Luther King in April of this year. But those awful events give us ample warning that in a climate of extremism, of contempt for the rights of others, of disrespect for law, violence may bring down the very best among us. A nation that tolerates violence in any form cannot expect to be able to confine it to just minor outbursts. The violence must be stopped quickly, finally, and permanent.
Psychosurgery, is that a reasonable practice?
No.
Even for the most serious of illnesses?
No.
Even after everything else has been tried?
I get the feeling you mean, is it a reasonable therapy?
Yes, that's right.
No, but it's not a therapy. That's the first thing that needs to be said, is it's an experimental procedure. Now, if we recognize that it's experimental, then we'd have to ask all your questions over again and say, is it a reasonable experiment?
Is it a reasonable experiment?
I would say it hasn't been conducted reasonably so far, and I don't see any signs that it's going to be. A reasonable, and I'm using the term reasonable to mean ethical, legal, and above board. That would imply, first of all and foremost, that the subject of the experiment is told that he's being experimented upon, and that isn't done.
Working in conjunction with a team of doctors in Boston, Dr. Delgado experimented on neurological patients to develop a treatment to scientifically disarm violent behavior. Doctors Vernon Mark and Frank Irvin were emerging stars on the psychosurgery scene, with claims that ghetto rioters were just the beginning, that millions could be suffering from some ambiguous, undiagnosed brain disease and turn violent, despite the fact that the brain remained little understood in its complex, interrelated functions.
Each patient wears a stimulus, which receives a signal via radio that stimulates electrodes in the brain. Meanwhile, electrical signals of brain activity are sent back by telemetry, while the patient moves freely through the hospital ward.
It can't be missed that this work was the logical progression of the CIA's MKUltra subproject 94 for the, quote, continuation of investigations on the remote directional control of activities in selected species of animals through miniaturized stimulating electrode implants in specific brain center areas. During this time, Dr. Delgado's work was funded by the Office of Naval Research, which was later exposed as a conduit for covert funding for the CIA's MKUltra projects. Officially, however, the contractor who carried out this research is still unknown to this day. A FOIA request sent to the CIA for any information regarding contract work Delgado may have done for them was returned with a letter that the agency could neither confirm nor deny Dr. Delgado had ever worked for them.
Behaviors such as aggression can be evoked or inhibited.
Just as with primates and other animals, Drs. Delgado, Mark, and Irvin could hijack bodily functions and invoke some rather precise behaviors in their human patients, who, unlike their counterparts in the animal kingdom, could verbally describe what they were feeling and experiencing.
There was a slight euphoria. The patients were definitely changed. Relaxed, enjoying themselves, frequently smiling, some laughing out loud. They wanted more. A female patient reported a pleasant tingling sensation in the left side of her body. Quote, from my face down to the bottom of my legs, unquote. She started giggling, openly expressed her fondness for the therapist, who was new to her, kissed his hands, and talked about her immense gratitude for what was being done for her. Repetition made the patient more flirtatious, until she openly expressed her desire to marry the therapist. Similar ESB response was generated in an 11-year-old boy who also reported fondness for the therapist, causing the child to state that he wished he was a girl instead of a boy. From about 200 other points, ESB produced unpleasant reactions including anxiety, sadness, depression, fear, and emotional outbursts. A female patient reported feeling threatened, that she thought something horrible was going to happen, a premonition of imminent disaster of unknown cause. Some patients said they just felt as if their minds were blank or as if they had been drinking a lot of beer. Still others were overcome by uncontrollable rage.
Dr. Frank Irvin would later describe how
one could sit with one's hand on the knob and control the level of the patient's anxiety.
Now, can you tell me if there's any change at all?
In one of our patients, stimulation through implanted electrodes evoked a flexion of the right hand. When the patient was warned of the oncoming stimulation and was asked to try to keep his fingers extended, he could not prevent the evoked movement and said, "I guess, doctor, that your electricity is stronger than my will."
Curiously, many human patients, though aware of their treatments, were inclined to try and rationalize their actions when triggered by stimulation as though it were natural behavior.
Electrical stimulation in one of our patients produced head turning and with a well-oriented sequence, as if the patient were looking for something. This stimulation was repeated 6 times over 2 days. The patient considered the evoked activity spontaneous and always offered a reasonable explanation for it. When asked, "What are you doing?" the answers were, "I'm looking for my slippers," "I heard a noise," "I am restless," and "I was looking under the bed."
Using these electrodes to target specific points within the behavioral centers in the brain, which the doctors claim were contributing to a patient's violent behavior, they would deliver their treatment by destroying these points with microwave radiation in something of a micro-lobotomy. attempting to erase the capacity for these negative emotions altogether. A direct disciple of Dr. Robert Heath, Dr. Frank Irvin was a neurologist and psychiatrist who spent his formative years in the seedy New Orleans atmosphere of experimental brain research before being appointed head of the Stanley Cobb Psychiatric Laboratories at the elite Massachusetts General Hospital. The methods of deep brain stimulation that Frank Irvin acquired under Heath would now be put to even more controversial use in attempting to eradicate human violence. Irvin's partner and co-author, Dr. Vernon Mark, an associate professor in neurosurgery at Harvard Medical, had been associated with Massachusetts General Hospital since 1949 and spent nearly a decade overseas at the height of the Cold War in a specialized neurological wing at a U.S. Air Force hospital in Germany before coming home to be named director of neurosurgery at Boston City Hospital. Doctors Mark and Irvin worked in state-of-the-art facilities under the direction of Dr. William Sweet, a Harvard medical professor and chief neurosurgeon at Massachusetts General who, just like Dr. Wilder Pinfield, was a Rhodes Scholar and studied under Sherrington at Oxford. Dr. William Sweet, co-inventor of proton emission therapy, had long been experimenting on patients with radiation at Mass General. Some of this work, including injecting 11 terminally ill and comatose patients with uranium, was classified under the auspices of the U.S. Atomic Energy Commission.
The United States government actually did carry out on our citizens experiments involving radiation. While most of the tests were ethical by any standards, some were unethical, not only by today's standards, but by the standards of the time in which they were conducted.
Allegations of patient abuse and disregard for informed consent were later pursued in court, but never quite caught up to the prestigious and highly connected Dr. Sweet. To give you a little idea of the mindset these men brought to the operating table, Dr. Mark pointed out, quote,
"Moral values are social concerns, not medical ones in any presently recognized sense."
And in an interview, Dr. Irvin told Mind Manipulators authors Alan Shefflin and Edward Opton, "The brain-damaged children and senile elderly people are sometimes, quote, monstrous little organisms, and the kind of violent patients he treated were, to most doctors, a pain in the ass." Dr. Irvin also noted about his work that,
"We're not talking about being nicer to people. I make no human argument at all. We're really talking about being socially cost-effective."
I did not expect to be a reformer in psychiatry. I did not expect, in particular, to be the first physician to ever come out publicly opposed to lobotomy and psychosurgery and to take a public stand about it. I realized that psychiatry was going in a very bad direction. I went into private practice and I expected to write novels, maybe books about psychology, and to help people being a therapist. I was just sitting there reading newspapers and I opened up a psychiatric newspaper and in it I found an announcement of the Second International Conference of Psychosurgeons. The first one had occurred decades earlier at the height of psychosurgery. I couldn't believe it. They were meeting in Copenhagen and they were giving an honorary degree of some sort of honorific prize to Walter Freeman, who had lobotomized 5,000 Americans during the great wave in the North America that really took the brains of about 50,000 people, never opposed by anybody significantly in the medical field. I sent out requests to every single conference attendee that I could find. I finally got the agenda of the conference, and I asked them all who else did they know who was doing psychosurgery. I told them I was a young researcher at the Washington School of Psychiatry, where I have my office. What came in freaked me out. I could not believe the stuff these people were sending to me. What I found that most upset me was that at the University of Mississippi in Jackson, a surgeon named O.J. Andy was operating on little children as young as age 3, 4, and 5 for hyperactivity, aggressivity, difficult behavior, without even pretending to have psychiatric diagnoses or serious disorders. These were institutionalized children. O.J. Andy was inserting multiple electrodes into various portions of these children's brains. He was stimulating them, and then he was burning holes in their heads with the electrodes by heating them up. And he was then studying the children who walked around on the ward with wires dangling out of their heads. I called the chairman at the Department of Psychiatry at the University of Mississippi, and he said to me, O.J. Andy, I know O.J., he's down the hall from me, his office is. I said, did you know he was putting electrodes into the brains of little children? He said, oh God, no, I did not know that. It was the only genuine expression of horror I ever got, I believe, from anybody in establishment medicine or psychiatry. They set up a committee at the University of Mississippi to require a scientific protocol for O.J. Andy, and he was the first project I stopped. He never submitted anything there.
After founding the Center to Study Psychiatry and raising awareness about psychosurgery in Congress, renowned author and psychiatrist Dr. Peter Breggin started the project to examine psychiatric technology, bringing national and then international attention to the blatant lack of scientific, political, or ethical critique of the disturbing trend of psychosurgery and electrical brain stimulation.
Mental illness is a myth, a fraud, a bad metaphor, an excuse, a rationalization. It's a religious viewpoint held by psychiatrists which says that human troubles are somehow medical in origin and medical in their solution. Now, just how poverty, unemployment, unhappiness, fights between husbands and wives, beatings of children, anxiety, alienation, just how all these problems relate to medicine and relate to illness is never stated.
I might not have ever even had any kind of a movement get started, but became an international movement because I couldn't get any science writers interested. I couldn't get anybody to cover it. In fact, I called the Journal of Nervous and Mental Disease and asked them if I could do an article on psychosurgery, and he said, what are you talking about? Jose Delgado's a dear friend of mine.
In September 1967, following another long, hot summer of urban race riots in major cities across the U.S., Drs. Mark Irvin and Sweet wrote a controversial and timely letter to the Journal of the American Medical Association, suggesting that riot leaders could be suffering from brain dysfunction. This would prove to be a turning point.
In 1967, rebellions erupted in the Detroit black community. In a letter to the Journal of the American Medical Association, three neurosurgeons, Drs. Sweet, Irvin, and Mark, put forth a theory as to the cause of the violence in Detroit. They said in part, I quote, there is evidence from several sources recently collected by the Neuro Research Foundation that brain dysfunction related to local lesions plays a significant role in the violent and assaultive behavior of thoroughly studied patients. Their idea was subtle but clear. The reason individuals were violent during rebellions was due to a brain dysfunction which they felt surgery could correct.
Then I found, of course, the JAMA article where they talked about it at length, explaining how ghetto rioters must have abnormal brains because not everybody was rioting. So clearly, people who weren't rioting had normal brains, and the few who were leaders. We're talking now about men you could name, like Rap Brown and others. We're talking about some men who were outraged at the conditions of life in which the children were growing up in these ghettos. And these men were, from the perspective of many in the black community, the only hope. They were heroes.
Of those heroes, Dr. Sweet was quoted as saying,
we're talking about senseless behavior. The proponents of urban disorders seem to be the people who are most likely to suffer from organic brain diseases.
And the idea that a leader must be the crazy one because you don't agree with them ideologically or because you're afraid of them Doesn't make any medical sense, but boy, did it make political sense. Wow.
The kind of violence that we're talking about here, social unrest among a population in a repressed community, can only be seen as a kind of brain dysfunction by ignoring the legitimate causes of the behavior. And my reaction to the letter from which you quoted and to the whole idea of trying to deal with social violence as if it was something wrong inside of the people's heads who are violent is a way of refusing to look at the legitimate social causes of a very important and significant kind of behavior.
To the extent that medical science has created this new, in quote, technology, there is the desire to use it, you see, and the most logical population to use it against are poor people, black people, and people who are incarcerated.
The Boston doctors called for an extensive research project to identify the early warning signs of violent behavior and pinpoint, diagnose, and treat people in inner cities with what they termed low violence thresholds before they had actually committed any violent acts. And what do you know, but their JAMA letter just so happened to include specific language taken directly from the good doctor's own proposal for a brand new research project which aimed to do just that.
I found out that William Sweet had actually talked to the New York State Legislature trying to get funding, describing how this surgery of stimulating brains and melting holes in the heads of people might be a cure for ghetto violence, because surely the leaders of the violence were abnormal and had abnormal brains that could be fixed with psychosurgery.
The first phase of the Boston Violence Project was officially titled The Medical Epidemiology of Criminals. For it, Drs. Mark Irvin and Sweet had designed a 5-hour-long multi-phase screening process, which included 17 psychiatric and psychometric assessments, 5 hormonal assays, chromosomal fingerprint and dermatoglyphic analyses, an EEG, and what they called a cyber-medical evaluation. The doctors suggested these factors could somehow indicate which individuals were more prone to commit violent acts than others, singling them out for preventative neurological treatments before they could pose a danger to society. The project was seemingly the perfect cure to what was then being declared society's greatest illness. Right on cue, a vast, coordinated media campaign was underway to promote it to the public.
Good evening. Violence is making fortresses of portions of our cities and dividing our people into armed camps.
Grievances in the United States are more intense now than they've been at any time since the 1930s.
There's crime, individual resort to force.
Those who commit violence are basically no different from other people. Man from birth has a potential for violence, but the incidence of violence can be controlled and prevented by conscious changes in man's environment.
Mark Irvin and Delgado were featured guests on many TV programs. And article after article filled the newspapers about their amazing new work.
Is violence then as American as cherry pie?
I believe that assertion was attributed to Rap Brown, was it not? That violence was as American as cherry pie. As an historian, I would observe there's a great deal of truth to that, unpleasant as it may be.
Doctors Mark and Irvin declared that brain dysfunction was just as important a factor as poverty, unemployment, and substandard housing in provoking not just urban riots, but social protests, fully politicizing what was defined as violence. In June 1968, it all came to a head. Robert F. Kennedy was assassinated, and during his speech that evening responding to the tragedy,
I am appointing with the recommendation of the leadership of the Congress, with whom I have talked this evening, a commission of most distinguished Americans to immediately examine this tragic phenomenon.
President Johnson announced the creation of the National Commission on the Causes and Prevention of Violence. Drs. Delgado and Irvin would later turn up as consultants on commission staff reports.
President Johnson created the National Commission on the Causes and Prevention of Violence. Today, a task force of that commission released its first findings, concluding that Americans have become a rather bloody-minded people.
Concludes that Americans always have been a violent people.
Americans have always been a violent people, according to the commission, so much so in the 1960s that the commission ranks the United States first among 17 Western countries in total magnitude of strife.
Just 2 weeks later, the Omnibus Crime Control and Safe Streets Act of 1968 was rushed through Congress, creating the Law Enforcement Assistance Administration, which would fund hundreds of controversial, coercive, and even downright Orwellian behavior modification projects in the years to come.
Then joined in the Justice Department. At the time, there was a notorious section called LEAA. They joined in the funding in a collaborative effort between the U.S. Justice Department and the National Institute of Mental Health. I mean, this was, for me, eye-popping.
But it labels as unprecedented the scope and magnitude of anti-war protest, campus unrest, and what it called the chilling recent contagion of political murders of national leaders.
Violence, in this progress report, cannot be eliminated, but can be better controlled, and that, it says, is an urgent imperative.
The medical epidemiology of criminals, however, was simply the screening stage for a larger Boston violence project that Drs. Mark, Irvin, and Sweet couldn't seem to get approved. It was rejected by Harvard's Institutional Review Board. Massachusetts General's Committee turned it down on both scientific and ethical grounds. And even an ad hoc committee put together outside of MGH unanimously rejected it. It was then the project was forced to move to Boston City Hospital, an institution which the doctors knew would look the other way and ask few questions due to its own issues with corruption and mismanagement at the time. Unable to get approval through above board channels, Drs. Mark, Irvin, and Sweet then formed the Neuro Research Foundation, a nonprofit organization based out of Sweet's personal home that existed only to fund the doctor's research. Dr. Delgado sat alongside the other three on the foundation's board of trustees. This new foundation would enable the doctors to essentially handpick their own medical ethics review panel, thus circumventing the standard safeguards for human experimentation. See how that works? With no one else to stand in their way and a positive report on behalf of the Neuro Research Foundation, the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare would finally approve the Boston Project, and NIMH and the LEAA would fund it. 2 days after that crime bill was passed that would fund their work, Life magazine featured the psychobiology of violence on its cover, another story lauding the work of Drs. Mark, Irvin, Sweet, and Delgado. In it, the public was brought face to face with contrasting photos of monkeys with surgically implanted wires sticking out of their heads, having their rage dialed up in Delgado's lab, and 20-year-old Julia S., a young woman prone to emotional outbursts, decked out in head bandages, frantically slamming herself into a wall under the influence of brain stimulation, just like those monkeys. Illustrating that man and animals were little more than biological machines to be controlled and tamed with technology. In fact, in one of Delgado's publications, he didn't mince words when he referred to his experimental animals as mechanical toys under his command. The demure Julia was now the poster child of the hidden rage that could be lurking in any human being, but also of violent tendencies successfully located and cured by remote brain stimulation and psychosurgery. In reality, Mark and Irvin's treatment left Julia permanently brain damaged. At the same time, the New York Times was advertising her as a great success story, with claims that she had zero uncontrollable rage fits since her second brain operation, was back at home and even singing in a church choir. Dr. Mark was forced to admit to a Boston reporter that Julia was actually in an institution, where she would likely remain for the rest of her life. Despite this glaring inconsistency, one after the other, Dr. Jose Delgado and Drs. Mark and Irvin published books to garner wider public and financial support for their work. Delgado's 1969 book, Physical Control of the Mind, Toward a Psycho-Civilized Society, spells out in graphic, controversial detail exactly what the aim of such technology ultimately is: behavior modification and control at a society-wide level.
The technology for destruction has now placed at the disposal of man a vast arsenal of ingenious weapons which facilitate all forms of violence, including crimes against property, assassinations, riots, and wars, threatening not only individual life and national stability, but the very existence of civilization.
The New York Times promoted Delgado's book with the headline, "What kind of humans would we like to construct?"
Is it feasible to induce a robot-like performance in animals and man by pushing the buttons of a cerebral radio stimulator? Could drives, desires, and thoughts be placed under the artificial command of electronics? Can personality be influenced by ESB? Can the mind be physically controlled?
Meanwhile, headlines in newspapers all across the nation warned Americans that the United States was so overrun with violence. Unless some type of massive, widespread political and social reform was undertaken immediately, America was on track to become a nation of garrison cities where, quote, order is enforced without due process of law and without consent of the governed. The following year, Mark and Irvin published Violence in the Brain. In a spectacular act of self-aggrandizement, the doctors dedicated the book to themselves, writing, "This book is dedicated to the Neuro Research Foundation of Boston, whose goals for the early diagnosis and proper treatment of the violent patient parallel our own." In the book's foreword, Dr. Sweet essentially agreed with Delgado, writing, "Our project holds out the hope that knowledge gained about emotional brain function in violent persons with brain disease can be applied to combat the violence-triggering mechanisms in the brains of the non-diseased. In essence, everybody else."
Violence in the Brain. Vernon Mark, neurosurgeon at Boston City. Frank Irvin, psychiatrist at Harvard. William Sweet, this powerful neurosurgeon during the introduction. And the book is about a man at the time called Thomas R. Thomas was a brilliant engineer with patents who was terribly violent and who, after the surgery, was now completely cured without any symptoms. And the surgery consisted of putting multiple electrodes in his brain, stimulating him while he walked around the ward, then burning out parts of his brain.
No patient was more highly publicized as a success of Mark and Irvin's new techniques than Thomas R., whose real name was Leonard Kyle, their star patient who, according to their book, was diagnosed as suffering from temporal lobe epilepsy and prone to uncontrollable rages that the doctors were only able to subdue through remote brain stimulation and a bilateral amygdalectomy, which destroyed portions of his brain closely connected to emotional behavior.
Well, I knew this was a lie. I didn't realize how huge it was going to turn out to be. So I began to get a hold of every single thing I could find that they had written. I was able to put together that at the point they wrote in Violence in the Brain, that he'd been cured forever, he'd been just discharged from the hospital. It wasn't a follow-up at all.
In fact, Leonard Kyle's story was the backbone of Michael Crichton's novel-turned-Hollywood film, The Terminal Man, the inspiration for which came from Crichton's time on the ward in residency as a student of Dr. Vernon Mark. By most accounts, Leonard was described as a mid-30s married father of six and a successful self-taught engineer who worked with top defense contractors, including Douglas Aircraft, Polaroid, where he earned several patents under his founder, Edwin Land, who at the time was working with the CIA on the top-secret U-2 spy plane program, Honeywell, and eventually EG&G, one of the most powerful Cold War black ops defense contractors in America that no one had heard of, which had spun off from MIT and made important contributions to the development of the nuclear bomb, aerial reconnaissance, and radar. But in their book, Violence in the Brain, Doctors Mark and Irvin painted Leonard as an impulsive man with a violent streak who was prone to road rages and spousal and child abuse. A man who would sometimes pick up and slam his pregnant wife and even his children into walls. Although described as typically courteous, quiet, and reserved. Mark and Irvin insinuated temporal lobe disease led to Leonard's sudden violent rages, and the doctors went so far as to describe him as, at times, frankly psychotic, suffering periods of confusion, delusions, and hallucinations. The supposed focus of Leonard's anger and marital disputes centered upon what were depicted as paranoid suspicions his wife was cheating on him with a tenant who was renting a room in their home.
And his wife had been the one to refer him to treatment. And the treatment people had referred him to Mark Irvin and Sweet, who had all this equipment and no patient. And it had gone through the VA. They'd taken him right off the VA wards. It's the power of these people.
Leonard's medical records, however, showed no evidence of temporal lobe disease. In fact, outside of mild depression, Leonard's records showed no evidence of paranoid delusions or any psychotic symptomology at all.
The VA records showed him to be entirely normal. His brain waves were normal. He was normal. There's nothing really in the record that shows anything serious. And then they took him and put him in their project.
Here the timeline gets fuzzy. During the spring of 1966, Leonard was officially admitted to the Violence Research Unit, where Mark and Irvin claim they spent months trying many combinations of anti-seizure medication, tranquilizers, and psychic energizers, but to no avail. So Dr. Mark implanted an array of at least 80 electrodes into Leonard's brain. Leonard wrote to his mother and described what was being done to him in Boston as the stuff of science fiction.
During my conversations with Helen Geis, his mother, she brought me a telegram. These are the days of telegram from Vernon Mark. She had written him and said, "I hear my son is undergoing surgery. Can you please tell me about it?" And the telegram said, "Don't worry, your son is undergoing minor surgery." We had it in print.
The doctors outfitted Leonard with one of Dr. Delgado's stemoceivers, which sent a steady stream of telemetered EEG data analyzed by a computer for an impending violent episode. Then the computer would decide when to remotely stimulate Leonard based on the data. The doctors note that Leonard was a landmark for them. It was the first time they were able to demonstrate that systems in the limbic brain both start and stop attack behavior in man.
Then I found a very obscure article by these men, maybe so obscure they didn't expect anybody would find it, and it said that he'd become psychotic while they were stimulating him. And it described how he was saying, "I don't want this anymore, I don't want this anymore."
Egregious lack of consent aside, now they had a remote trigger for human aggression, a type of activation of a human being by remote electronic means. Just like one of the major goals of the CIA's MKUltra subproject 119.
They would just toy with his brain. They would toy with it while he was walking around and he didn't know it turned on, so he didn't even know what was happening to him.
For months, Mark and Irvin remotely stimulated Leonard's brain by computer, meticulously figuring out what each electrode could do. Some made him feel like he was losing control, others like he was floating on a cloud. It was during this stimulation-induced relaxation that the doctors suggested making destructive lesions in the medial portion of both of Leonard's amygdalas. While under the influence of stimulation, Leonard agreed to the surgery. Even Mark and Irvin admit in their book that after the stimulation wore off, the idea of anyone's making a destructive lesion in his brain enraged him, and it took many weeks of patient explanation before Leonard finally accepted the idea of bilateral lesions.
And then he became peaceful and accepted the treatment after they stimulated him enough. This is key, folks. Passivity, docility, obedience is key to this entire process.
Leonard's wife was also brought in and supposedly threatened to leave him if he didn't consent to the treatment.
Leonard believed that his wife was having an affair. Leonard's wife denied it and sent him to her psychiatrist. Leonard had been in conflict with his wife, but he'd done nothing more serious than one sort of violent event. Not a nice thing. He threw a can at his wife of food and didn't hit her. That was the only fact I could find in the records that remotely resembled violence, and it was reported by his wife.
Despite eventually going through with it, Leonard's wife not only filed for divorce while Leonard was still in the hospital, she eventually remarried to the very tenant Leonard had been worried was having an affair with his wife all along. After a series of lesions were burned into his brain via passing high-frequency microwave currents through his electrodes, Leonard was finally discharged in August 1967, after more than a year in the hospital, a year that would change the course of his life forever.
Now, can you tell me if there's any change at all? Now, can you tell me if there's any change at all? Can you tell me if there's any change at all? Now, can you tell me if there's any change at all? Now, can you tell me if there's any change at all? Now, can you tell me if there's any change at all? Now, can you tell me if there's any change at all? Now, can you tell me if there's any change at all? Now.
One of the big breakthroughs was when I was on the air talking about Thomas R., whom I also saw at one point had also been called Leonard K. Apparently somebody heard me on the radio and called Leonard's mother. And I got a letter from Leonard's mother, and it said, "Now I understand. I knew they turned my son into a vegetable," she used that word, "but now I see what it was, what they were doing to him. He's been horribly destroyed since he came back from Boston. He's had multiple hospitalizations, chronic patient at the VA."
It wasn't until after his treatment in Boston that Leonard committed his first official act of public violence. After moving across the country to live with his mother in Long Beach, Leonard was arrested a few months later for a fight in a nearby town and wound up undergoing the first psychiatric hospitalization of his life at a California VA. Now hallucinating, delusional, and confused, Leonard was admitted to a lockdown psych ward and placed on heavy doses of psychotropic drugs. Less than a year after being released from Mark and Irvin's violence project, the VA declared Leonard 100% disabled.
I flew out to California and I met Leonard. This man who was written up, violence in the brain is a cure without side effects, cured of his violence, who was the star of the story by Crichton called Terminal Man, as sort of the miracles of psychosurgery, except it went awry electronically. This man was on weekend leave at his mother's house. He was lying in bed, and his head was covered with a tent of newspapers. He was in terror. He said, "Doctors from Boston are trying to get my brain." He said, "I'm the most intelligent person in the world. I have an IQ of hundreds, and they're trying to get my brain."
While it is impossible to know what Leonard was really involved in here, it is worth noting that he claimed the experiment he endured specifically involved hooking geniuses up to IBM machines.
It was a post-traumatic brain injury psychosis. Terrorized.
Leonard went from brilliant engineer and gainfully employed husband and father of six to a patently deranged, chronically hospitalized, sometimes violent psych ward patient after his treatment in Boston. He never worked again and spent the rest of his life heavily medicated in VA hospitals in both California and Boston. Despite this, doctors Mark and Irvin continued to write journal articles about their great success story, Thomas R.
And by the way, I would find out that Mark, Irvin, and Sweet knew this. They knew this while they were writing their cure papers. She said he'll wander off and they'll pick him up in an emergency room. And he'll say that doctors from Boston have been manipulating my brain and put holes in my head, and they wouldn't believe him. They'd call him a paranoid schizophrenic, send him back to the VA.
Leonard was also diagnosed as schizophrenic reaction paranoid type, in large part due to a fantastical story he told with great technical precision about what had been done to his brain in Boston. When he was finally discharged in May 1968, Leonard's records read, "Patients stated that Massachusetts General Hospital were controlling him by creating lesions in his brain tissue by microwave, and that they had placed electrodes in his brain tissue. Stated that they can control him, control his moods, and control his actions. They can turn him up or turn him down. Just like a mechanical toy."
I said, "I want to get his records. But I'm afraid if we ask for them, they'll purge them." I went back to Boston with a letter that I was to obtain a complete copy of Leonard Kyle's records. And I called Boston City Hospital. And they said, "We have no such record. It's in Dr. Mark's private office." Isn't that interesting? I called Dr. Mark's office. And I said, "I'm at a telephone booth with a reporter." I gave him the name. "And if you don't deliver me a copy of those records in 24 hours, we're going to publish it that you haven't done it." And I'd had awfully good coverage in Boston, and I got the records. In those records, I found things like, "Leonard wants to leave the ward. Progress note by Frank Irvin, take his pants away." I was looking in on the life of a man who'd been as violently abused as any horrendous sexual, emotional, physical abuse. He might as well have been in a brainwashing camp in North Vietnam or North Korea, being tortured. One of the first things that fell out of the records was a handwritten note by him that doctors from the MGH were killing him or taking his brain or something to that effect. It was right in there. In the progress notes, I saw writing on the walls, "murder." That's all, just writing on the walls. Murder. And the VA records did not note that he'd had psychosurgery. But I was able to show that, in fact, Mark had been in communication with the VA.
Mark Meanwhile, as the American public was being sold this treatment as a potential cure for violence.
When you look over other civilizations that were once center stage in the world, and now are some of them just footnotes, it wasn't because the barbarians came in and destroyed them. It was because they fell because of their failure internally to do that which had to be done and do it in time.
This track of technologically driven brain research was more than just the next logical step in medicine. Decades of work was converging on the threshold of a vast, far-reaching, covert agenda finally being realized. The activation of man.
Dr. Horace W. Magoon, considered one of the fathers of neuroscience, was also focused on activation in 1948 when he co-discovered the reticular formation in the brainstem, responsible for sending electrical signals and brainwaves that activated waking and sleeping states and seemed to hold fundamental sway over consciousness as well, which deeply fascinated cybernetician Warren S. McCullough, who'd known Magoon since their days in Chicago.
At the Illinois Neuropsychiatric Institute, Warren McCullough, Gerhard von Bonin, and a number of young research-oriented neurosurgeons, in a high-spirited atmosphere of excitement in the basement lab at the INI, was a novel and stimulating experience.
An eager McCullough invited Magoon's closest associate, Donald B. Lindsley, a psychologist and neurophysiologist, to the Macy's cybernetics meetings back in 1949. The following year, Drs. Horace Magoon and Donald B. Lindsley, along with Dr. John French, assembled a powerful team based out of the neurological wing of the Long Beach, California VA hospital.
California.
Curiously, the same one Leonard Kyle would be treated at in the aftermath of his participation in Mark and Irvin's experiment in Boston. By 1950, this Long Beach VA facility had become no mere veterans hospital. Under Magoon, Lindsley, and French, it had become the premier neurophysiological lab of its day, a brain research mecca tied to UCLA's medical center that attracted leading scientists from around the world. By the 1960s, this cutting-edge facility boasted more than 60 patient beds set aside solely for neurological research, with hundreds more for psychiatric and mental patients. And experimentation carried out there on veterans involved deep brain microelectrodes, as well as computers programmed to analyze brainwave frequencies. So it is puzzling, at best, why after Leonard Kyle was admitted to the VA in 1968, the staff so quickly and easily dismissed his claims of having had psychosurgery and electrodes in his brain as the paranoid delusions of a schizophrenic. This particular veterans hospital and its brain research lab became the nucleus of UCLA's new brain research institute.
For the first time, man now has the tools to explore the living brain. Tiny wires, electrodes, can be placed inside the brain and hooked up to recording machines, as in this experiment at UCLA's Brain Research Institute. The chimpanzees have been trained to play a game of electrical tic-tac-toe. They are competing against each other. Only the winner gets a reward.
Five years after MKUltra had officially begun, a special Macy's conference was formed in 1958 to exchange information on the central nervous system and behavior, chaired by Dr. Horace Magoon and facilitated by Macy's Foundation Medical Director and Massachusetts General Neurologist Frank Fremont Smith. The conference editor was one of the most powerful doctors inside Massachusetts General Hospital, Mary A.B. Brazier, an EEG expert and polymath neuroscientist from a well-connected family, who had immigrated from Britain at the onset of World War II on a Rockefeller fellowship to work in Stanley Cobb's specialized department at MGH. The group's participants were steeped in secrecy and had deep ties to clandestine intelligence agencies. Among these were neuroscientists who experimented with the pain and pleasure centers of the brain, alongside CIA and MKUltra contractors, as well as representatives from the DOD's Research and Engineering Branch and the Walter Reed Army Institute for Research. This Macy's Central Nervous System group also hosted a number of distinguished scientists from within the USSR. This series of conferences served as a springboard for the Moscow Colloquium on Higher Nervous Activity, a significant moment at which American scientists contracting with defense agencies worked with, rather than against, the Soviets during what was supposedly the height of the Cold War.
Why is it that everything the other side says is propaganda, while we call what we say information?
With backing from the Rockefeller Foundation, the Macy's Foundation, and the National Science Foundation, Mary Brazier and Horace Magoon would lead a small delegation of Americans to Moscow in October of that same year, at a time when such travel was otherwise heavily restricted and rare, to convene with the ideological successors of Pavlov, who were working on the, quote, mechanization of the central nervous system. For years, Stalin had forbid cybernetics in the Soviet sphere, despite its origins in the physiological labs where Pavlov studied his dogs. However, Stalin's conspicuous death in March of 1953, just 1 month before the official start of MKUltra, had opened the door to both Soviet and world cybernetics. Declassified documentation has revealed that indeed, Dr. Mary Brazier had a close relationship with the CIA, and that her liaison was on an intimate first name and even nickname basis with both her and Horace Tidd Magoon. Additionally, it was revealed that the CIA had also directly sponsored at least part of the Macy's Central Nervous System meetings. 1958 proved to be a pivotal year. But one more meeting was necessary to set the stage for the activated man. In June, Boston was host to the Sensory Deprivation Symposium, drawing together an elite cadre of cyberneticians, neurologists, and CIA MKUltra contractors to coordinate the next decade of clandestine brain research. The event was jointly sponsored by Harvard Medical School, Boston City Hospital, and the Office of Naval Research. This connection was acknowledged by Donald Hebb, who admitted during the conference that his work on isolation, quietly sponsored by the Defense Research Board of Canada, began with the, quote, problem of brainwashing, but that he and his fellow researchers were not permitted to say so in their first publication. Hebb had been invited by the Macy's and Rockefeller Foundation-funded Dr. Stanley Cobb, who presided over the symposium, and praised Dr. Hebb's, quote, courageous experiments on sensory deprivation, as well as his, quote, ingenious ideas on studying perception in human beings through isolation techniques. Attending this symposium was a familiar cast of characters, including a key unit of cyberneticians, Norbert Wiener, Warren McCullough, W. Gray Walter, and Lawrence Kuby, alongside UCLA Brain Research Institute's Horace Magoon, Donald Lindsley, and Mary Brazier, who is transferring to UCLA's Brain Research Institute, as well as MKUltra contractor Dr. Louis Jolyon West, who is about to lead the UCLA Neuropsychiatric Institute. Also attending was a young Dr. Frank Irvin, who had recently transferred from Tulane working with Dr. Heath to take over the Stanley Cobb Chair of Psychiatry at Massachusetts General. Dr. Cobb marked 1958 as a watershed year for progress in understanding the central nervous system, presenting a radical new picture of activity in the brain based on reverberating circuits, feedback systems, communication theory, and the modulation of sensory perception, all of which became central to the fields of physiology, psychology, information theory, and cybernetics, as well as the aims of the CIA's MKUltra program. Thank you. This new core of knowledge replaced the classical understanding of the brain. It would now be treated as a biocomputer, to be scanned, screened, decoded, and reprogrammed.
By 1960, the word cybernetics was used by the Soviets to designate this new trend. This new science is considered by some as the key to understanding the human brain and the product of its functioning, psychic activity and personality, to the development of means for controlling it, and to ways for molding the character of the new communist man.
Norbert Wiener had first attempted to tackle what would become his greatest challenge in 1930, when W. Gray Walter asked him for help in interpreting what were considered at that time random EEG readings that doctors and engineers the world over had yet to make any sense of. Later noting a similarity between the oscillating, scanning behavior of a brain and that of a radar dish, both constantly searching for new data inputs, Wiener began to theorize a complicated harmonic analysis of these EEG waveforms. Harmonic analysis accounted for the transmission of information in a whole new way, which eventually connected with the core cybernetic principle of feedback.
And we must get rid of any notion straight away that control is something imposed on the system from outside. It has to be built into it. It's called feedback, and feedback is ubiquitous in control systems.
If one could modify the way the brain processed signals, one could program the brain, the behaving entity, just like the equipment in missile control rooms and just like the experimental animals who'd been conditioned to perform predictable behaviors in the lab. By 1955, Norbert Wiener, who'd long ago sworn off work on, quote, weapons of war, despite his continued collaboration with the very military technicians and defense contractors who'd made those weapons, had overseen the completion of a powerful new device, which he created with Massachusetts General's electrical engineer John Barlow and Walter Rosenblith, an Austrian-born engineer who ran MIT's Communication Biophysics Laboratory. Mary Brazier, too, would work on this big project, which would become one of the Cold War's least known but most powerful secret weapons. They called it the autocorrelator.
The apparatus made an enormous clatter. The 24 relays in the rapid repeater, the central processing unit that correlated one waveform with another, chattered incessantly among themselves. The clanking kept up for 20 minutes for each correlation, until the machine spit out its completed correlogram and came to a thumping, self-satisfied halt. Norbert Wiener loved the racket. He was captivated. He was absolutely fixed on the printout as it was coming out. Wiener's goal for the project was nothing less than to find the Rosetta Stone for the script of the brainwaves.
A machine that analyzed brainwaves in analog mode. As authors Conway and Siegelman wrote, the correlator was Wiener's baby, the first analog computer to apply his statistical methods automatically to the analysis of brain function. Wiener considered the machine to be the most significant work of all the things he had ever accomplished. It took Norbert Wiener 25 years to crack the code of EEGs. It was the culmination of cybernetic research that he and Arturo Rosenbluth had begun on automata and feedback more than a decade earlier, leading up to the first Macy's Cybernetics meeting on cerebral inhibition in 1942. In cybernetic terms, EEG represented the first known language which was not symbolic, but rather communicated directly and powerfully in its expression. The autocorrelator now made it possible to interpret brainwaves intelligently and automatically via computer, and for that computer to send a reciprocal response back through EEG to excite or inhibit brain activity. And when Mary Brazier transferred to UCLA for the opening of Magoon's Brain Research Institute, she brought the autocorrelator with her. Years later, all of this would have grave consequences for Leonard Kyle.
They turned him into a shell of a human being, where the spirit was still there, but it couldn't peep out very well through the tangled wires, the murdered brain cells. He was psychotic, and he was violent when restrained at times. He'd never been anything like that. Never been anything like that.
The Boston Violence Project continued with funding through the NIH and the LEAA. Dr. William Sweet was so powerful and had friends in such high places that in 1971 he was able to directly petition Congress for funds for their violence study, bypassing the ordinary process. The project, unlike your average scientific and medical proposals of the day, was aided by an organized political campaign to garner congressional support run by one of Washington's top lobbyists.
These guys went to Congress. They got a direct science grant from Congress. Congress doesn't give grants for scientific research. They came up with $500,000. They gave it to NIMH, completely bypassed all the review processes of NIH, and said, you give it to Mark Irvin and Sweet for their research.
This is how high up the chain this project truly went. All of this despite the fact that brain lesions such as Leonard's were well known for years to cause something called Kluver-Busey syndrome. In 1939, psychologist and mescaline researcher Heinrich Kluver, a core member of the Macy's Cybernetics Group, and his colleague neurosurgeon Paul Busey observed that monkeys who received bilateral temporolimbic lesions fell victim to a multitude of permanent behavioral effects, including everything from docility to psychic blindness, or the inability to appropriately recognize the emotional importance of events, such as the ability to feel fear. The same effects were produced when lesions were burned into the amygdala as well.
So now I found myself looking at what looked like one of the worst, most egregious, involuntary, brutal experiments ever reported in the medical literature, and nobody but me that I could find anywhere seemed to be bothered by it.
One unlikely source of concern came in the form of neurologist Dr. Ernst Rodin, who visited the Boston group after reading Violence in the Brain, hoping to gain information he could apply to a similar experiment he planned to run on violent sex offenders out of the Lafayette Clinic in Detroit. Dr. Rodin came away with a very different picture of what was actually going on in Boston than what was reported in Mark and Irvin's book. The nursing staff informed him that, despite supposedly being a project about the treatment of violent criminals, none of the 35 patients in Mark and Irvin's initial study were violent criminals, or even truly violent people. Dr. Ira Sherwin, the Boston Project's head neurologist, concurred with the nurses and stated that he was not aware of any genuinely successful cases, including Julia S. and Thomas R. Of Violence in the Brain and Mark and Irvin's research, Dr. Rodin concluded, "We have been misled." Maybe now is a good time to mention that, just like Drs. Heath and Delgado, a FOIA request to the CIA regarding any contract work done by Drs. Mark, Irvin, or Sweet for the agency was returned with a statement that the agency could neither confirm nor deny that the men had ever worked for them.
So we have these American surgeons, some of the most famous in the country, getting funding from a combination of NIMH and the justice. Can you imagine anything more totalitarian than putting psychiatry and justice together?
By 1972, internal LEAA memos show that the agency decided not to renew Mark, Irvin, and Sweet's funding, due to, among other things, the fact that they discovered Dr. Irvin was vacating the Boston Project without informing the LEAA to take up a new position at UCLA, in addition to evidence of the misuse of federal funds, including the fact that Irvin had used grant money to purchase equipment from a firm in which he was the major stockholder. The agency also noted that despite being proposed as the entire point of their research, the present proposal contains no attempt to develop treatment or follow-up procedures for the patients involved. Because, as it should be glaringly obvious by now, that is not what this was ever about.
In chimpanzee Patty, brainwaves telemetered from the left and right amygdala were received and automatically analyzed by an online analog computer. This instrument was instructed to recognize a specific pattern of waves. The computer was also instructed to activate a stimulator. Each time the waves appeared, radio signals were sent to Patty's brain to stimulate a point known to have negative reinforcing properties. Electrical stimulation of one cerebral structure was contingent upon specific EEG patterns in another area of the brain. And the whole process of identification of information and command of action was decided by the online computer.
In this process, Patty's very capacity for carrying out certain behaviors was drastically and rapidly altered through a very sophisticated form of computer-driven conditioning, which continued until the offending brain activity was no longer physically possible.
2 hours after the brain-to-computer feedback was established, activity in the amygdaloid nucleus was reduced to 50%. 6 days later, with daily 2-hour periods of feedback, drastically reduced to only 1% of normal occurrence.
The experiment showed how brainwaves could be singled out and virtually eradicated. Using the autocorrelator, EEG expression was filtered, altered, and domesticated. The project moved forward.
Does it tamper with minds?
But no matter what the cost, the American people are prepared to pay the price of victory.
Going the people to accept these monstrous treatments that do nothing but destroy brain tissue and dehumanize people.
Let us march toward the clean world our hands can make.
Does it tamper with minds? Does it tamper with minds? And if so, does anyone have the right to do that?
Leonard would die 3 decades later at the age of 65 at the Bedford VA just outside Boston, having spent the latter half of his life a totally disabled, heavily medicated mental patient in a psych ward. Despite having completely ruined a man's life after mutilating his brain, Drs. Mark and Irvin continued to publish success stories about Leonard's case up until at least 1975.
But I wouldn't, even if they were convicted of murder, want to unleash these psychosurgeons on them. There are protections against cruel and unusual punishment. Believe me, it is crueler to have done to you what was done to Leonard Kyle than to be put to death. It's crueler and more hopeless and more horrible.
In May 1972, Dr. William Sweet again personally approached the Senate Labor and Health Education and Welfare Appropriations Committee for more money. This time, Sweet was asking for $1 million to branch out, to open a series of violence institutes like the Boston Project for the Study of Violent Behavior across the nation. Sweet stated on the record that his appearance before Congress was on behalf of not just himself and colleagues at Harvard and MGH, including Dr. Vernon Mark, but also the Brain Research Institute of UCLA, in addition to UCLA's Neuropsychiatric Institute, under the medical direction of Dr. Louis Jolyon West. Dr. West spent his entire career first in the military and later in academia, researching all manner of behavior modification, everything from cults to communist mind control techniques, dissociation, hypnosis, sensory deprivation, hallucinogens, for which he attended cybernetician Frank Fremont Smith's Macy's conference on LSD, social engineering, and more. As a psychiatrist, Dr. West reportedly examined Lee Harvey Oswald's assassin Jack Ruby, homicidal cult leader Charles Manson, infamous kidnap victim Patty Hearst, the man convicted of assassinating RFK, Sirhan Sirhan, and even convicted Oklahoma City bomber Timothy McVeigh. He also reportedly monitored Hite Ashbury's so-called acid ghetto before and during the Summer of Love. It wouldn't be revealed until years later that Dr. West was involved in CIA MKUltra research, that he was the main contractor in charge of Subproject 43 with a top-secret clearance, a project involving the altering of personality through sensory isolation and environmental manipulation, including the use of drugs and hypnosis. Dr. West's book, Hallucinations, is dedicated to aforementioned cybernetician Heinrich Kluver, of Kluver-Busey syndrome fame. Unsurprisingly, right on cue, Dr. Irvin and other Boston Project associates were on their way to California ahead of Dr. West's new project, as mentioned by Dr. Sweet to Congress, the Center for the Study and Reduction of Violence at UCLA. Sounding just like Drs. Mark, Irvin, Sweet, and Delgado, Dr. West decried the growing plague of violence as our greatest ill, and claimed his was just the project President LBJ's Violence Commission had called for to cure it. The massive project would take many of the same ideas from Boston and expand them to screening the general population at large in the name of preventing, detecting, controlling, and not just treating, but pre-treating all manner of antisocial and violent behavior, to somehow stop it before it could occur. Broad in scope, the project called for experimenting on people of all ages and from all sectors of society, including children, menstruating women, anyone deemed predisposed to alcoholism, criminals, mental patients, people diagnosed with brain disease and dysfunction, and more. Race was obviously considered a cause of violence, as the project involved plans to monitor students and introduce experimental anti-violence treatment programs at two different junior high schools, one in a predominantly Black ethnic area, and the other in a predominantly Chicano area. A wide variety of experimental treatment methods would be employed, including everything from newly developed but unapproved chemical castration drugs, to monitoring, quote, abnormal electrical brain activity, specifically using surgical intervention by implanting tiny electrodes deep within the brain, end quote. Dr. West noted, it is even possible to record bioelectrical changes in the brains of freely moving subjects through the use of remote monitoring techniques. Sound familiar? A full third of the research projects the center ostensibly planned to carry out were based upon attempts to link violence prediction to what they deemed abnormal brain waves.
Irvin, for example, made remarks that, to the effect that being a do-gooder or goody-two-shoes or nice to people, that was a pretty good idea, but you wouldn't get any money from that. So they knew that the way to get money was to play on political and social fears and on racism. And these men are just riding that horse of violence, riding that horse of, I'm right, you're wrong. I'm white, you're black. I'm a neurosurgeon, you're a nobody. And they're just riding all of those negative human emotions, integrating it into totalitarian philosophies.
The ultimate goal of all this research was described as the ability to predict violent behavior, the development of mass screenings for the general public in order to officially label any violence-prone individuals of all ages before they actually committed an act of violence, and then initiate preventative treatment in the form of behavior modification of such individuals, even though they had not committed any crimes or done anything wrong yet. For many opponents, the UCLA project was a real-life version of the Stanley Kubrick film A Clockwork Orange. The center was described in a congressional hearing as a laboratory for the Department of Corrections and law enforcement officials with the diaphanous veneer of UCLA. Prisoners and patients at state hospitals and medical correctional facilities would also be used as guinea pigs for this experimental research, including those being held at Vacaville, Camarillo, and Atascadero. Vacaville had recently had its experimental maximum psychiatric diagnostic unit shut down following public outcry after it came to light that three prisoners had been amygdalotomized to inhibit their aggressive tendencies in 1968, with disastrous results. All of which the prison attempted to deny ever happened at first.
One of the things that I had not imagined early on was all of this might have political implications. It didn't dawn on me. I'm embarrassed at how naive I was about life. I had no idea the treachery of outstanding people in the field of medicine, psychiatry, neurology, neurosurgery.
Through all of this, Dr. Bregan continued to publish articles and make public appearances speaking out against the Orwellian violence centers and their experimental treatments.
I was not going to stop. I was just not going to stop about this.
Again, unsurprisingly, in the initial proposal dated September 1972, Dr. Frank Ervin was listed as a UCLA faculty member who had already submitted research to the project before it even officially began, on violence in the brain, bioelectrics, and behavioral studies. Once again, it became apparent this project had already been approved in the upper echelons of government, when then-California Governor Ronald Reagan proudly announced the formation and $1 million funding of the UCLA Center in his January 1973 State of the State Address. In the weeks that followed, however, the plans for the center were leaked to an already anxious public by Director West's opponents inside his own neuropsychiatric institute. Protests began breaking out on the UCLA campus and outside the NPI. Protests against the use of psychosurgery to curb violence. Protests against what some called a clockwork orange at UCLA. Protests against the obviously racist and sexist overtones of the proposal. And considering Dr. Ervin's timely presence at UCLA just prior to the project's announcement, protests against Drs. West and Ervin personally. Several students were even arrested after they chained themselves to Dr. West's desk. The project's proposal went through at least four revisions as Dr. West frantically attempted to rebrand his new violence center and regain public trust. Frank Ervin's name was removed from all subsequent drafts altogether. So was any trace of reference to psychosurgery, something that in the meantime Dr. Mark redefined in journal articles specifically as the creation of lesions in the brain and not the drilling into the skull for the placement of electrodes. This weak semantic argument allowed Dr. West to proclaim that his center was never going to be involved in psychosurgery of any kind, despite the fact that the placement of deep brain electrodes in test subjects, possibly including children, was a stated objective in his first proposal draft. By 1974, they even took the word violence out of the title, renaming the whole thing as the UCLA Project on Life-Threatening Behavior. Despite all the edits and reassurances, internal documents continued to get leaked to the press, and public opposition continued to build. Funding for the project itself was finally pulled and the project officially abandoned, after a shocking letter was leaked which hinted at something far more sinister than what Dr. West had adamantly tried to sell to the public. The letter was written by Dr. West to a man who appeared to be his good personal friend, Dr. J.M. Stubblebine, then Director of Health in the California State Office of Health Planning. It read, "Dear Stubb, I am in possession of confidential information to the effect that the Army is prepared to turn over Nike missile bases to state and local agencies for non-military purposes. They may look with special favor on health-related applications. Such a Nike missile base is located in the Santa Monica Mountains within a half hour's drive of the Neuropsychiatric Institute. It is accessible but relatively remote. The site is securely fenced and includes various buildings and improvements making it suitable for prompt occupancy. If this site were made available to the Neuropsychiatric Institute as a research facility, perhaps initially as an adjunct to the new Center for Prevention of Violence, we could put it to very good use. Comparative studies could be carried out there in an isolated but convenient location of experimental or model programs for the alteration of undesirable behavior. Such programs might include control of drug or alcohol abuse, modification of chronic antisocial or impulsive aggressiveness, etc. My understanding is that a direct request by the governor, or another appropriate officer of the state, to the Secretary of Defense, or of course the President, would be most likely to produce prompt results. Needless to say, I stand available to participate in any way that might be helpful. Louis Jollyon West, M.D., Medical Director. And there it was, in black and white. Dr. West planned to use his confidential political back channels to acquire a newly decommissioned Nike missile base, complete with underground facilities and nestled high in a remote area of the Santa Monica Mountains, and turn it into a research facility to perform his experiments, altering people's behavior in a place he personally described as securely fenced and isolated. And that was the last straw. Public outcry drowned out Dr. West's best attempts at downplaying his center's true goals. The project was, at least officially, shut down.
We are advancing rapidly in the pattern recognition of electrical correlates of behavior.
Dr. Delgado's highly publicized taming of the bull was just the opening act before the real show began.
Automatic learning is possible by feeding signals directly into specific neuronal structures without conscious participation.
What struck me about Delgado, first of all, was that he was a political philosopher. He wasn't just a psychosurgeon that put electrodes in the brains of people and bulls. And he was a political philosopher who saw the fundamental principles of America, the Declaration of Independence in particular, as being scientifically incorrect based on the neuroscience of the 1960s, that humans aren't individuals. They're under the influence of all kinds of forces. That means they're not individuals. They may feel self-important, but they're not important. And they may think they had rights as individuals, but the society had rights, not the individual. His view was 100% consistent with society versus the individual, doing anything to the individual in the name of the social good.
Humanity behaves in general no more intelligently than animals would under the same circumstances. And this alarming reality is due largely to spiritual pride. Violence is a product of culture and environment, and is an extreme form of aggression. Man may react to unpleasant and painful stimuli with violence. A major role of education is to build internal controls in human beings so that they can withstand external pressures and maintain internal equilibrium.
It was a totalitarian philosophy under which he was doing social control and personal control of people.
Cybernetics was first described by Norbert Wiener as communication and control in the animal and the machine. Human languages have remained complex in their unraveling and interpretation. Even computer languages must be defined. In cybernetic terms, EEG brainwaves represented the world's first known non-symbolic language, able to directly communicate signals and meaning into the partitions of the mind. Direct communication was key. Man had uncovered a pathway to decode brainwaves, to interpret EEGs, and to encode reciprocal messages that a computer understands and responds to automatically. This was sophisticated, technologically driven mind control in action. Most people simply can't grasp such a thing. Can't think it, imagine it, or believe it. An emotional plea is deaf to the drone of society, and each person learns to live according to its rhythms. Saul Sell's work on MKUltra Subproject 119, proposed and put into action in 1959, sought to activate the human organism by remote electronic means using bioelectric sensors, a lead with 24 channels of brainwave data, recording and data processing devices, and what Sells called an autocorrelator, the very machine the MIT and MGH teams developed to analyze and interpret EEGs. While the first autocorrelator of 1955 took 20 minutes to analyze Norbert Wiener's brain, subsequent versions of the device could surely approach real time, and with infinitely more channels of data. By the 1960s, Dr. Delgado demonstrated that his devices could automatically monitor, correct, and recondition the very mental capacities of his experimental subjects. And that is an idea unlikely to be forgotten.
Can the human mind be controlled and remain human? Many of today's developments were predicted 35 years ago in what was then called a fantasy. Its title, Brave New.
Is the mind merely a function of the brain? Or is it a separate but closely related element? In the past 50 years, we have come to recognize that in the brain, there is an amazing automatic sensory and motor computer that utilizes the conditioned reflexes. And there is a highest brain mechanism that is closely related to what men have long referred to as consciousness, or the mind, or spirit. But the mind, I surmise, can give direction only through the mind's brain mechanism. It is all very much like programming a private computer. The program comes to an electrical computer from without. The same is true of each biological computer. Purpose comes to it from outside its own mechanism. This suggests that the mind has energy. There I must leave it.
The 1967 Webster's Dictionary defines cybernetics as the comparative study of the automatic control systems formed by the nervous system and brain, and by mechanical electrical communication systems. In 2008, the CIA declassified the historical record of the agency's Office of Scientific Intelligence, 1949 to 1968. In it, there are a few mentions of cybernetics, including a classified research program and a biocybernetics working group, the responsibility for which fell under a CIA medical subcommittee. References were also made to Soviet cybernetics programs, East-West technology exchanges, and something called World Cybernetics. Even though this document wasn't declassified until 2008, all of the pages describing the CIA's cybernetics program are still redacted to this day.
I have puzzled over human evil for a long time. And I'm not sure I have more to say about it than anybody else, except I'm willing to call it human evil, which most folks aren't anymore. What was driving Mark Irvin and Sweet? What was driving Delgado?
Dr. Jose Delgado wrote that conquering the human mind is a national goal at parity with conquering poverty or landing a man on the moon. The main aim is to establish a scientific foundation for the creation of a future psycho-civilized society. But how many people knew that humanity's new future course toward a psycho-civilized society could be traced back to a highly organized global program to unlock the black box of man's mind, established during World War II, funded by elite foundations, government health and intelligence agencies, and military research branches, run through Ivy League schools, hospitals. Mental health facilities and prisons, and involving a diffuse global network of intelligence agents, neurologists, psychologists, psychiatrists, physiologists, anthropologists, mathematicians, and cyberneticians, all seemingly working under the same United Nations UNESCO goal for decades. How to create peace in the minds of men.
The governments of the states parties to this constitution, on behalf of their peoples, declare that since wars begin in the minds of men, it is in the minds of men that the defenses of peace must be constructed.
In summary, therefore, there is no evidence that the Soviets have any techniques or agents capable of producing particular behavioral patterns which are not available in the West.
Form figure eight, run a couple on the right, run a couple on the right, run a couple on the right. Form figure eight, run a couple on the right, and chase the goose all round. Round and around and round and round, round and round and round and round, round and round and round and round, chase the goose all round. Form figure eight, run a couple on the right, run a couple on the right, run a couple on the right. Form figure eight, run a couple on the right, and chase the goose all round. Round and round and round and round, round and round and round and round, round and round and round and round, chase the goose all round.